Welcome to the webinar on contraception in the ongoing Bridging the Gap series, filling knowledge gaps organized by Society of Meaningful Life Management with AOGD. Jackson Paul Pharmaceutical presents contraceptive to fulfill the contraceptive needs of your patients. Divacon tablet of levonorgestrel 150 mg with 30 micrograms ethine estradiol, Kyra tablet of disoergestrel 150 micrograms with 330 micrograms of ethine estradiol, and Cristalia 35 mg tablet. We welcome the esteemed faculty present with us today. Welcome, dear attendees. Please post your queries by text in Q&A box. Please note this webinar is streaming live on Jackson Paul Facebook Live. The recording will remain on Jackson Paul Medical Insights, our YouTube channel, for reference and promotion. We're pleased to have our webinar series with Dr. Mahinder Ahuja, a progressive thought-provoking leader who created Progress of Going Digital, online voting, e-newsletters, online journals. She is founder president of SMLM, past president of IMS Fox, vice president SAFOMS, executive member of many societies dealing with health of women like ISAR, IFS, ISPAT, NARCHI. She has been felicitated in many awards and many publications and research papers to her credit. We will now welcome request Dr. Mahinder Ahuja to please kindly initiate the proceedings.
Thank you very much. Good evening to everybody and welcome to all the esteemed faculty and all the delegates who are here on this very, very important webinar series under the umbrella of Society of Meaningful Life Management and in collaboration with AOGT also. And just a few words, why the Society of Meaningful Life Management was formed to give a holistic care to the health of women of this country. Because we are somehow or the other, even in the women health, we are divided into so many organizations that we are not able to give actual health care to women, which is required. So it's not, we just don't have to give a symptomatic treatment to the women, but in the total, the health of the women should be taken care of. So that was one of the agendas. Second was to reach out to the many doctors. So that's why our first agenda was to go digital. And we had registered in September 2020, our other website was also launched. And all of you must visit website smlm.in and look at its aims and missions and the way forward we have been. So we have our key opinion leaders from all over the country and not even country, from international countries also. And we have been having webinar series on the Bridging the Gap. So our purpose is to bridge the gap, knowledge gap between healthcare professionals and that whatever is new things are happening. Secondly, healthcare professional and patients, which is a big gap which is coming up. Thirdly, in the various stakeholders who are not coming to one thought process as far as the health of the women of this country is concerned. So today we have a luminary of guest with us, and none other than Dr. Ajay Khera, who is himself a very progressive, thought-provoking leader, is here. Along with, we have Dr. Chandravati, who is the doyen of the medical profession and gynecology care. As far as we concerned, I think she is the topmost. And Dr. Achala Batra, who is the president. And then we have a luminary of speakers, Dr. Kavita Agarwal, Dr. Parag Biniwale, and our young champion, Shaila Jamal, is there. And because I think it's time for us to start training and bringing our new torchbearers into this profession for the healthy future of this association. And then we have a team of our chairpersons, and all of them are going to be for the roundtable discussions later on, because we have to find an answer to what are the challenges in the contraception today. Why, after 70 years of independence, still we are not able to meet the needs, and there is such an unmet needs in the contraception is concerned. Now, as far as contraception is there, the word says no conception. So there is no life. But in reality, contraception is the life thread of women of this country, because that does not just mean a pregnancy which they don't want. Beyond that, their health concern, their mental health, social health, education of the women, their family, their economic need, their unwanted pregnancies, which lead on not only to abortion, but mortality even, and lots of morbidity. So that means we have to prevent a lot of things if we are able to meet the demands of the contraception, which are there, and it's all over the world. But in India, definitely, we in our country have to find out what are the way forward there are. So with these words only, I think I'll hand over to Dr. Shaila Jamal for future conduct, for further conduct. Can you please show her CV, Dr. Shaila Jamal? Please, all of you, unmute yourself. Yes. So she is our young champion, and she already has Foxy Leaders of Tomorrow Award, North Zone in charge for YTP Foxy. She's the associate professor in the RMRI Bareilly, and she is the India Book of Record holders also, Foxy PSC Award, Award for Honor by WHO. So already she's working so hard, and she's always ready to help you. So Shaila, I'm really honored to have you here with already so many publications of chapters and organization of so many state level conferences, gold medal in PG and UPCOG, and India Book of Record holders. Welcome to you, Shaila Jamal, our young torch holder for the women's health. So please take over from here to you, Shaila.
Thank you so much, and good evening to all the respected faculty, delegates, and viewers. और आज हिंदी दिवस है, तो मैं दो तीन लाइन हिंदी दिवस के ऊपर ही बोलना चाहूंगी और हिंदी में ही बोलना चाहूंगी. सो सुस्वागतम, और आप सब लोगों का हार्दिक अभिनंदन है सोसाइटी ऑफ मीनिंगफुल लाइफ मैनेजमेंट के प्लेटफॉर्म पर. और हम एसोसिएशन ऑफ ऑब्स्टेट्रिशियन एंड गायनेकोलॉजिस्ट ऑफ दिल्ली, जो कि इस टाइम डॉक्टर अचला बत्रा मैडम लीड कर रही हैं, उनके बहुत बहुत आभारी हैं. मैम, हाथ जोड़कर आपको प्रणाम, और आपके साथ जुड़ने का सौभाग्य हमें मिला. सो मनिंदर मैम की ये विजन कि हम सब तक पहुंच जाएं किसी तरह से, और जब डिजिटल प्लेटफॉर्म एक ख्वाब था, तब मैम ने डिजिटल प्लेटफॉर्म को अपने हाथ में रखा, और उस डिजिटल प्लेटफॉर्म के थ्रू मैडम ना सिर्फ लोगों के एकेडमिक्स में पहुंची हैं, मैं समझती हूं कि मैडम लोगों के दिल तक भी उतर चुकी हैं. सो आपका स्वागत है. हिंदी दिवस, हिंदी मात्र एक भाषा नहीं, हमारी मातृभाषा है. सो इस प्यारी भाषा के साथ आज हम अपने प्रोग्राम की शुरुआत करेंगे, और हमें बहुत सारी ब्लेसिंग्स देने के लिए हमारे आज के चीफ गेस्ट डॉक्टर अजय खेरा सर हमारे बीच मौजूद हैं. डॉक्टर दीपिका, आप सर का प्लीज सीवी डिस्प्ले कर दीजिए. सर का हालांकि पूरी पूरी कंट्री को कोई इंट्रोडक्शन की जरूरत नहीं है, लेकिन यहाँ पर हमारे साथ बहुत सारे ऐसे बच्चे बैठे हैं जो सर को अपना आइडल मानते हैं, आइडलाइज करते हैं, और सर जैसा बनना चाहते हैं. सर इंडिया कंट्री रिप्रेजेंटेटिव हैं इन जेंडर हेल्थ, पब्लिक हेल्थ स्पेशलिस्ट, कौन उनका नाम नहीं जानता। सर कमिश्नर मेटर्नल एंड चाइल्ड हेल्थ, मिनिस्ट्री ऑफ हेल्थ एंड फैमिली वेलफेयर, गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया के ऑफिस को हेड कर चुके हैं सितंबर 2018 टू मई 2020। उससे पहले सर WHO कंसल्टेंट एट WHO इंडिया ऑफिस न्यू दिल्ली में कार्यरत थे, डिप्टी कमिश्नर इन चार्ज ऑफ चाइल्ड एंड एडोलेसेंट हेल्थ प्रोग्राम, मिनिस्ट्री ऑफ हेल्थ एंड फैमिली वेलफेयर, और बहुत सारे पोजीशंस जो कि हम सिर्फ अभी सपने में ही सोच सकते हैं। हमसे मेरा मतलब है मेरे जैसे लोग, मेरे से बहुत ज्यादा सीनियर और बहुत एकम्प्लिश लोग आज यहाँ पर हम सबको ब्लेसिंग्स देने के लिए मौजूद हैं। तो सर आपका बहुत बहुत स्वागत है हमारे इस प्लेटफॉर्म पर। हमें मालूम है कि हमें आज आपसे अच्छा विजनरी और ल्यूमिनरी इस प्रोग्राम में एज चीफ गेस्ट के लिए मिलना मुश्किल ही नहीं, नामुमकिन था। और मैं मनिंदर मैम आपसे रिक्वेस्ट करूंगी कि सर आप सर के स्वागत के लिए दो शब्द कहें और फिर सर हमें ब्लेसिंग्स दें।
डॉक्टर अजय खेरा, गुड इवनिंग एंड नमस्कार। जैसे शैला ने कहा, हिंदी हमारी मातृभाषा है और विमेन हमारा सेंटर है। विमेन इज द एक्सिस ऑफ द सोसाइटी, अराउंड इट्स नॉट ओनली हर फैमिली बट पूरी की पूरी सृष्टि और नेशन और घूमता है। तो इसलिए उसकी हेल्थ बहुत इम्पॉर्टेंट है। आपको वेलकम कहना मेरे लिए बहुत बड़ा सौभाग्य है। आई फील ऑनर्ड बिकॉज द पर्सन्स हु आर रियली कमिटेड टू द हेल्थ ऑफ वीमेन ऑफ दिस कंट्री आर नियर टू माई हार्ट ऑलवेज। सो आई थिंक दिस वेबिनार इज गोइंग टू जॉइन अस फॉर द फ्यूचर मैनी मोर एक्टिविटीज टूगेदर, बिकॉज to have wonderful persons like you associated with our is activity is really an honor for us to, and I will be honored if you can say a few words about the contraceptive unmet needs and how you are committed to the health of women and how do you feel that we should be moving ahead. But please stay on till the end also, because we will need your pearls of wisdom later on also when we are doing the discussion and your guidance to us how the way forward should be. Please, Dr. Yeah.
So first of all, thank you very much, Dr. Maninder, Dr. Shahla, for inviting me to join this important webinar. And this particular webinar is on a very important subject, which is the contraception barriers and challenges. I will also like to take this opportunity of congratulating the Society for Meaningful Life Management and AOGD for organizing this important event. You all must be aware that contraception is a kind of a method or a contraception service, contraceptive services. You know, these are linked with the family planning. I think historically, whenever you talk about contraception, people think you are talking about family planning. But if you look at the available data sets, available Lancet publication, it clearly says that contraception can really help in preventing large number of maternal and newborn mortality. You know, I was reading some literature, and it indicated that if you can address the unmet need of the woman, you know, the 20% of the maternal and newborn mortality can be prevented. So that means contraception is such a powerful intervention if we are really want to have the right health of the woman and the newborns. So that's, you know, important thing. You know, why I'm raising this point? Because generally, if you go and go to the different parts of the country where the family planning indicators, which is called as the number of births, average number of children born to a woman, which is called as the total fertility rate, TFR in the country is going down. You know, it has gone to 2.2, 2.1, and there are some parts of the country where the TFR has gone less than 2. And that's why what is happening is, all along, if you visit different parts of the country, the politicians and the policymakers, you generally say, don't now talk about family planning now. enough has happened. But what I want to convey here is that contraception is an intervention which has to be continued over a period of time. It doesn't have to stop because new cohort of couples will keep coming and you have to continue providing those contraceptive services. Actually, it has to be equated with the services like immunization. You know, you continue to give immunization so that you can prevent diseases in the children. Similarly, you have to continue giving contraception, whether to, you know, for the spacing purpose or as a permanent method, but we have to continue to give that effort. So this is, you know, one message which organization must continue to impress upon, that this is not a temporary phenomena, it has to be a continuous process. And then the second important thing is, as on today, in India still, you know, we have an unmet need of around, you know, 12%. Now 12% looks very small, but if you convert this into a number, it comes to around, you know, 40 million eligible couples. They are not in a position to get contraceptive services, what they need. So that means in India, we still have to make, you know, number of efforts to reach to each and every woman in the country, each and every eligible couple in the country. And only then we'll be able to achieve our sustainable goal of, you know, universal access to the sexual and reproductive health services. So that is the third important point. And then the fourth important point, which I would like to mention here, is that the government of India, as you know, has shown a lot of success in the area of, you know, controlling fertility. But the spacing is a big challenge in India. I don't know how many people are aware of it. Every year we have around 25 million births are happening in India. And out of them, you know, 60% births are happening with a shorter interval of less than 3 years. And as you know, that if pregnancies happen at a shorter interval, the risk to both the woman and the newborn is much higher. So spacing is the one area for which contraception needs to be promoted. And the government of India has provided new initiative, like, you know, injectable contraceptive. Maybe in the past, we had only permanent method of sterilization, but number of new, you know, kind of a modern methods of contraception are being rolled out at the nation level, which we should feel proud of. But we as an organization, we must make sure that, you know, bouquet of services, the basket of contraception must be offered to every woman, you know, which could be injectable contraceptive, which could be oral contraceptive. And recently, as you must be knowing, that the, you know, the progesterone only pill has also been put as a part of the, you know, the programs. And then there is the non-steroidal, you know, kind of a contraceptive, which is called as the centchromin. So there is a complete range of, you know, modern contraceptives are available. And I'm really very happy to note that in this particular webinar, you are talking about those critical areas. I think one of the topic which has been kept as the progesterone only contraceptive. I think that must be in the back of your mind. This is a new contraceptive. Government of India is struggling. And you as an organization are always coming forward to support the government, to help the India in terms of achieving their goal of reducing their unmet need, which is 12% as on today. And we certainly like to have the unmet need as the lowest one, you know, as minimum as possible. So I'm really very happy that the kind of the topic you have selected, which is really need of the hour. And I take this opportunity of, you know, conveying my best wishes to this deliberation, and my blessings are always with you. So with these few words, I stop here and thank you very much for this invitation. Thank you.
Those wonderful, wise words, and you have given us many thought processing, which we'll be discussing later on. But first, let's shall I honor our guest of honor, Dr. Achala Batra also. And Dr. Ajay Khera, please would stay on, because in the second half of the discussions, we will be actually going forward how we have all the stakeholders have to come together and what are the gaps which are required still there, why we have still have it, as you yourself said, 12% of unmet need.
privilege now to invite and introduce our guest of honor today, Dr. Nachla. Ma'am is professor in Department of Obstetrics and Gynecology, BMMC, Safdarjung Hospital, New Delhi. President,
excuse me, ma'am. Is there another device open? Because it's giving a lot of sound. Noise is coming.
From my side?
Yes, ma'am. Noise is coming. Lot of noise is there.
I've stopped it. Is it fine now?
Yes, yes, it's fine now.
Okay. So, our guest of honor today, Professor Nachla Batra, ma'am, from Department of Obstetrics and Gynecology, BMMC, Safdarjung Hospital, New Delhi. She is president of Obstetrics and Gynecological Society of Delhi. And she headed NARCHI or Delhi chapter in 2018, from 2018 to 2020, chairperson of Urogynecology Committee of AOGD 2019 to 21, chairperson of Rural Health Committee AOGD 2017 to 19. She has headed the various offices of this prestigious organization. She has been ex-editor of NARCHI, coordinator of COXI Critical Care Conference, and with COXI North Zone in 2018 also. Dedicated PG and PG for last 35 years, and it gives us thrills to say ki humne Achla ma'am se padha hai virtually ya unke paas jaakar ya unke pair chhukar ka aashirwad lekar. Aur Achla ma'am, bahut 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 swagat hai. Thank you. Aapne apne saath mein kaam kar diya. Ab aapse request hai ki aap please apne words mein.
Thank you so much, Ella, for the kind words. It's a pleasure to meet you, even if it is virtually. And it was very nice when Dr. Maninder told me that she wants to associate with AOGD for this very important topic of barrier and challenges to contraception. I personally believe that the barriers are there, challenges are there, and the barriers have to be broken by us only. That is why my motto is that I'm doing educational activities for doctors. But side by side, I'm doing public forum because public has to be made aware of what is available to them in contraception. So challenges are that so many people don't know what is available to them, how they can get it, and how useful it is. It doesn't have many side effects. There are so many taboos, cultural, educational, from the family. So those things have to be broken. So we have to reach out to public. Out of all the unintended pregnancies which occur, 80% occurs in people who have the unmet need. Probably they would have taken contraception, but we were not able to reach them, or they were not able to reach. So I think today's Dr. Khera has very nicely talked about all the problems which are there, and I think Maninder has put forward a very good program and a roundtable how to we can overcome these problems by talking to each other. And I think this program is going to be a great success, especially with Dr. Ajay Khera being there. He has always been there whenever we have called him for anything. I've not met such an approachable person when he was in Ministry of Health. He would come whenever we have called him, because if we have such people to promote causes like contraception, which is the need of the hour, it's not only that it is limiting family. The repeated pregnancies, they are also going for abortions, which are, unsafe abortion. We still at Safdarjung are getting cases of very bad cases of sepsis after abortion and incomplete abortion, bleeding patients. So I think providing appropriate contraception, I think it is the need of the hour that we promoted our own Indian non-hormonal Saheli Concentromin, because it is not there anywhere in the world's map because it is Indian and we don't do much trials. So I think that also should be part of our, meeting the challenges, because people would be very happy with non-hormonal contraceptive. They have a scare of hormones. So I think congratulations, Maninder, and I'm very privileged to be with Dr. Chandravati and all the other, stars you've called, Basa, Pratik Tambek, Kavita, who is the rising shining star from my own institute, my own student. So Thank you very much, Maninder, and I think this is going to be a great success.
Thank you, Dr. Achala Batra, for those kind words and the way forward thinking that we have to do public awareness programs, and that is what we will be discussing in roundtable also, that how to do those programs, how to implement these thought processes, that is the main thing. One thing SMLM believes in is in the collaborative work. That is why we have made a collaborative group of 13 organizations already who are dealing with the health of women of this country. I think slowly and slowly, though individually all the organizations, they are doing good work, but collectively of course they can do better as far as the implementation of different procedures, different techniques are concerned, or when we have to go to Government of India with our thought process for the what we think should be done. Because what the Government of India will be thinking, though they are doing lots of efforts, I think, and the things have changed a lot, because when I used to go to do PHC a few years back, and now when I'm going under the Prime Minister's Surakshit Matritva Yojana also, and I have taken up some health centers because I wanted to go to the periphery to learn about the health of women of this country. Sitting in our AC clinics, it is different scene altogether. And when we go outside in the periphery, it's a different scene altogether. So I have seen the government infrastructure has increased a lot in these years, during these years, especially after COVID. They have made so many things possible there, which makes us very heartening. Yes, the future for the health of women of this country is bright. So with these words, thank you very much. And Shaila, please take on from here.
Thank you so much, respected Achala ma'am and Maninder ma'am, for those kind words. So Maninder ma'am, aapki aage chahungi, Chandravati ma'am jaisi hasti hamare beech maujood hain. Program ko aage badhane se pehle hum Chandravati ma'am ka aashirwad bhi lena chahenge. Ma'am, Chandravati ma'am, aapka aashirwad chahiye.
Achha, mujhe उसमें रखा ही नहीं गया था तो मुझे पता नहीं था मुझे देना है बट शैला थैंक यू वेरी मच फॉर हैविंग मी हियर टुडे और जैसा तुमने कहा मुझे हिंदी मैं तो बहुत अच्छी हिंदी बोलने वाली हूँ यूपी में से पर अंग्रेजी बोलते बोलते हिंदी का हम लोग ने कुछ गड़बड़ ही कर दिया है बट आई थिंक हाँ हम लोग ज्यादा ही फॉर्मल होने लगे हैं फॉर्मली बोलने लगे पर एज यू नो वी हैव टू टॉक इन हिंदी विद आवर पेशेंट्स ऑल द टाइम एंड वही लैंग्वेज है जो उनके समझ आती है और अगर मैं रियली में कम्युनिकेट करना अपने पेशेंट से तो हमें उनकी ही भाषा में उनसे ही बात करनी चाहिए इनफैक्ट मैं इस प्लेटफॉर्म पे आके बहुत खुशी हूँ बिकॉज कंट्रासेप्शन मेरा वीक पॉइंट है और हर वक्त मुझे ऐसा लगता था कि शायद मैं कुछ कर लूं कि शायद पॉपुलेशन इंडिया की कम हो जाए और जिन जमाने में मैं दौड़ दौड़ के वजाइनल कैंप्स और लैप्रोस्कोपिक कैंप्स करती थी रात रात भर तो मुझे लगता था शायद मैं पॉपुलेशन को कंट्रोल कर लूंगी बट देन आई फेल्ट इट वॉज लाइक अ ड्रॉप इन टू द ओशन बिकॉज इन फैक्ट वी वर नॉट डूइंग वॉट वी रियली नीडेड टू डूइंग फ्यू लाइगेशंस फ्यू स्टेरिलाइजेशन वॉजंट द आंसर टू कंट्रोल द पॉपुलेशन And that was our wrong impression as an obstetrician and gynecologist also, what I felt later on, that we should have had a broader outlook and had taken a different way of looking at this and trying to really control our population, not by force, but more for by counseling, explaining, and making them understand what was the need to have it. So I hope today's platform will be discussing these challenges
yes.
and we will come out with some very solid results which may be useful to with practicing gynecologists and when we talk to our government officers or people who are looking these programs maybe our suggestions would be fruitful for them as well when we go a long way I wish this seminar a great success I wish Maninder Thank that you. She organizes such things again and again. We will be like love to have a part of this.
Thank you, madam.
Thank you very much, each one of you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Chandravati. I think you just simply cannot imagine how happy I am here to have you here. क्योंकि आप वो gems हैं society के gynecological profession की जिन्होंने actual में बहुत dedicated service दी हुई है. How many we will be having really dedicated to the health of women of this country?
Thank you. I don't know.
But you are here and you will be the torch bearers for our Shaila Jamal and everybody else who are
coming. Thank you. तुम शैला तो बहुत आगे निकल गई. तुम लोग तो बहुत आगे निकल गए. बच्चे लोग आगे निकल जाते हैं तो अच्छा ही लगता है. It's always a pleasure.
And I think आप लोग आपने बहुत pertinent point raise किए हैं कि हमने प्रॉब्लम को वहां से नहीं पकड़ा जहां पकड़ना चाहिए था. जाके एंड में पहुंच गए. हमें शुरू से पकड़ना चाहिए वो. आई थिंक हम लोग डिस्कशन में जाएंगे इसलिए मैं अभी उन चीजों के बारे में बात ही नहीं कर रही. ठीक.
थैंक यू सो मच रिस्पेक्टेड मैम एंड थैंक यू सो मच मनिंदर मैम. सो विद योर काइंड परमिशन वी वुड लाइक टू मूव अहेड विद आवर साइंटिफिक सेशन. कैन वी हैव द सीवीज डिस्प्ले प्लीज. So our foremost gratitudes and welcome to Dr. Deepak Bhagde, sir. Sir is immediate past president of SOGOG, past MD DGO with gold medal in 1981 from Ahmedabad. He has held several prestigious positions that includes heading the Department of Gynae, MP Shah Medical College, Jamnagar, Scientific Committee Chairperson of Gujarat State Gynecologist, President Jamnagar Gynae Society, President IMA, Member Board of Studies of Saurashtra University. He has been, he is an excellent orator and he gave oration at SOGO conference in 2014 and have delivered about 58,000 babies and that's a wow in private practice since 1985. So sir, with folded hands, we welcome you on this platform and request you to introduce the topic and speaker of the first session. Over to you, sir.
It's wonderful, Sleha. So good to see you here with Dr. Maninda, who made this program a success. You know, when you think about contraception, our idea is always estrogen progesterone. Now here we are going to hear something about only progesterone contraception. And I'm sure Dr. Shobha Govindi, the way I know her, is going to make sure that few of the participants, which is a tremendous, you know, the last figure I can see is about 157, is a good participant in on a working day. And Shobha Govindi, I'm sure, is going to make at least 10 of us, right, progesterone instead of estrogen progesterone. What do you say about Dr. Shobha Govindi? A lovely lady. Forget the post.
Just one word about Shobha Govindi. When contraception word is mentioned in Foxy Circle, Shobha Govindi's name comes first.
Yes, that's why she's heading the family welfare. Maninder, she's rightly heading the post as a family welfare committee chairperson.
Family committee chairperson.
Yes, so you know, she has been a part of, Bangalore Obstetric Gynecology Society president, organizing of a Foxy meeting, affiliation as the head of department and whatnot. But apart from all this, I'm sure what she is going to say will speak what she is. Dr. Shobha Govindi, we are all very eager to listen to.
Thank you.
The great. Welcome, Dr. Shobha Govindi.
Thank you. Thank you, Bhagde sir. It's indeed a privilege to be introduced by you because I consider you as one of the most sincere and senior Foxians that we have ever had. Thank you, sir, for introducing me. And Namaskar Chandravati, ma'am. आपसे आशीर्वाद मिल जाए अगर हमको तो सार्थक हो जाता है जीवन. एंड अजय खेरा सर, बहुत बहुत नमन आपका और हम बहुत आभारी हैं. आपने अपना बहुमूल्य वक्त निकाला और अपना अनुभव हमारे साथ विस्तार से शेयर किया तो मुझे लगता है कि बहुत गहराई है आपकी बातों में और आपने पूरे जीवन का जो निचोड़ है आपके पब्लिक सेक्टर के एक्सपीरियंस का हमको बहुत कुछ सीखना है आपसे. द पर्सन आई नीड टू थैंक टुडे फ्रॉम द डेप्थ ऑफ माय हार्ट इज डॉक्टर मनिंदर. एंड आई हैव नेवर टोल्ड हर दिस बट आई ऑलवेज फील इंस्पायर्ड by her energy. And I wish Maninder that I always address you by your first name because I feel you are ageless. Though you are senior to me, I know. But I would like to think of you as being ageless. And I think even when I am your age, you will still look the same as you are today. I may not match up to you. So you are such a wonderful icon of fitness and style and also progressive thinking. And that is the reason you have taken this subject today. Hello, Achla. Very nice to share the dais with you. And Parag and Sharmila. And of course, Ashish Kale. It's lovely to be here with all of you. Kavita, Meenakshi. Very good evening to all of you. So then it is my duty in the next few minutes to be very, very briskly telling you, taking you through the journey of progestin contraceptions and how valuable it is in our basket of choice today. So can the earth handle 12 billion people? And that is a question we need to ask. Probably not, because we can see the mountains also inhabited there. And population stabilization, will it be likely? In the coming century, maybe yes, by 2045, we should achieve population stabilization. Currently, the world is running around 7.8 billion, maybe more. And if stabilization efforts fail, we will be 12 billion by 2100. And that is a reality we have to carry in our hearts every day as we sit for our practice, looking at women who require contraception. India cannot take anymore. That we are very, very sure, because we are the second populous country in the world, 17.7% of the total world population, while having only 2.4% of the world area. In 2024, we are going to surpass China to become the most populous country. And these are the key facts. By the WHO in 2020 June, that there are 1.9 billion women. Maybe now there are 2 billion in the reproductive age group, out of which at least 50% have a need for family planning, 1.1 billion, out of which 800 odd women are using methods. 800 odd million women are using methods, but 270 million have an unmet need. So unmet need is a global problem, not just Indian. Only thing is, for India, it is a bit more stark and dark and, you know, much more serious. The proportion of need for family planning is satisfied by modern methods. Is an SDG indicator. 3.7.1 is the SDG indicator for FP method satisfied by modern methods. And it is 75.7% global figure in 2019. And for SDG to be achieved, it should become 85 to 90%. Yet, less than half of the need for family planning was met in Middle and Western Africa. So African countries, the unmet need is also high, like us. Only one method, male latex condoms, can prevent both pregnancy and STI, that is HIV, the most important one. And the use of contraception advances the human right of people to determine the number and spacing of their children. So contraception, family planning, is a fundamental human right. Just like we have a right for health, for air, for water, for a place to live, for habitat, same way family planning and contraception is a human right. What are the Indian facts? 18 plus crore women want to avoid pregnancy in India. Of these, 27%, almost one third, do not use any modern method. Unmet need, 9 out of 10 unintended pregnancies. So we can see those are the reasons. The main reason for unintended, 13.4 crore women in India use modern contraceptives, but out of them, it is 77% rely on female sterilization. And that is what Madam Chandravati said, that majority of women are using female sterilization and only 3% use LARC. I wish that these figures would be reversed and a good part of the sterilization will be taken up by the male. So a lot of distance to go. So what do we do know are these facts of the world population, which I have already told you, but what we do not know is that 2/5 of all pregnancies are unintended. And if unmet need is met, what can we avoid? We can avoid 71% of the unwanted pregnancy. We can avoid 22 million abortions. We can avoid 90,000 fewer maternal deaths. Unmet need for modern contraceptives in India, among all women, the modern contraceptive prevalence rate is 40% only. But if we offer the method, 74% of women will be satisfied with the modern method. Rate of satisfaction is very high. 19% of women have an unmet need for modern method. So if you consider only the modern method of contraception, the unmet need jumps from 13-14% to 19%. And MEC criteria is something which remains sacred for us today, and it should be the principle guiding our prescriptions and the wheel and its nuances and the projection of the life phases of the woman with the methods and these alphabetical supernumerics. Everything should guide us for prescription. And this is the ready reckoner with the red, orange, light green and dark green boxes, which tell us the MEC criteria 1, 2, 3, 4, and that should be under the glass top, tabletop of our consultation table. And so also should this. This is the effectiveness chart, and this should be placed so that the woman can see the arrow going up from her side. So it should be facing the woman, and it is easy for her to see that the long-acting methods are equally effective as the sterilization methods. Next are the other large methods, and then the hormonal, and then the barriers, etc. So increasing the choice is our prime duty today towards our women. Give them a better choice. And first comes, let us think about the pills, the progestins in pills, because today I have to speak about the progestin contraceptives. Well, if we come to pills, then it is the oral contraceptive combined pills which are used more often, and 25% of women all over the world use this. But we need to think about progesterone only pills also, because they are wonderful methods. It is also known as mini pills, synthetic progesterone, used effectively for women who have contraindications to estrogen, and the Levonorgestrel also used as emergency, not this formulation, but another one. And it can, the POP can be started at any time, at any time. That's why it is used both for quick start and also for bridging method of contraception for any woman where we believe that she is not pregnant. The progesterone amount is 50% of that of POC, so it's a very low dose. And what is available today is levonorgestrel, which was there earlier in the government basket. Now it is not there. What is available for us is desogestrel. I'm very sorry. 0.075 milligram serazet. That is what is available today. And of course, that is the way it acts. I will not be telling about the method of action for the August audience. Everybody knows it has got a slightly higher failure rate than the COC, but it is mainly because of lack of compliance, because most often we prescribe in the lactating women, and in younger women, it may be higher. Benefits, of course, are huge. It has very effective safety, and improvement in menstrual symptoms also is there as a beneficial side effect, safe in lactation. And non-contraceptive health benefits like relief of pain during periods, anemia correction, etc. Yeah. Minor side effect is some menstrual irregularity. Some instructions is that it can be started within 5 days of period, within 3 to 6 weeks of delivery, even in a breastfeeding woman. If more than 5 days from the period, maybe we need to offer them a cover of 2 days with condom. If more than 3 hours late from a missed pill, if it is a levonorgestrel pill, a backup of 48 hours is needed. But if it is a desogestrel, then there is a 12-hour window period and she can still take the pill. What about drospirin on 4 milligram, the new player in this basket? And this is an estrogen-free oral contraceptive, 4 milligram, yet to be launched in India. But this is something which is very effective, and most importantly, gives a 24-hour interval of safety from a missed pill. An indication, of course, is women who are older also can take, in whom estrogen is contraindicated also can take. In women who have some sexual symptoms of difficulty or minor side effects with the COCs, wish to change to another formulation, eminently can be put on this. What are the contraindications and the risks? WHO and the CDC says that the following are 3 and 4 for POP. Category 3 and 4 MEC criteria. It's breast cancer, liver problems, liver tumors, acute or recurrent DVTs, and pulmonary embolism. Let us look at this very, very apt WHO chart of MEC criteria specifically meant for progesterone-only contraceptive. It also includes LNG IUD in this, and this is for exclusively for postpartum contraception for breastfeeding women, where pills, implants, and injectables, all three can be used within 6 weeks of postpartum. within 6 weeks postpartum. So that is what we need to remember. These are methods which can be written on prescription or provided to women before they get discharged from the hospital after birth. And this can be in the list if they have not opted for PPI-UCD. So please remember, implant can be inserted, POP can be prescribed, and also LNG-IUCD also can be fitted in those women who accept more than 6 weeks to less than 6 months. Breastfeeding women can use all these methods with MEC criteria 1. When does it become MEC category 3? Breastfeeding women who are less than 6 weeks postpartum should not be using the injectables. So when we come to progestins, widely thinking about them, all of them together, then injectables cannot be given within 6 weeks. They have to be given after 6 weeks. More than 6 months postpartum, breastfeeding women who are more than 6 months can use all the methods, of course, with MEC category 1. So more than 6 weeks and more than 6 months, all are MEC category 1. Let us, before going forward, get oriented to the SARC versus LARC concept. SARC is short-acting reversible contraceptives. They are all the medicines, patches, rings available today. They are user-dependent, sometimes fall prey to inconsistent use, higher failure rate. There is a constant fear in the mind of the woman about the negative health effects because they are popping pills every day, and Indian women do not like popping pills. They prefer injectables. Women and healthcare providers need increased information to prescribe, and there is a more nuancing required to write these prescriptions, more reference to the MEC criteria. What about LARC? LARC removes the user error. It is long-acting reversible contraceptive, high satisfaction rate, continuation rates are better, low failure rates are there. LARC methods are all estrogen-free. And estrogen is primarily responsible for thromboembolic disorders. These are the LARC methods. So except for the copper IUCD, all others are progestin-based methods. We know that. Today, we have the Mirena and all its sisters and in the market, the progesterone-only subdermal, which is finally in its new role as etonorgestrel implant, 68 milligram, and this is actually the subcutaneous DMPA. So this, okay, we can see highlighted the failure rate, very, very low failure rate of LARC, and can you see that the implant has better performance than even sterilization methods, a contraceptive method which can give a 0.05 Pearl index, both with typical and perfect use, is really amazing. So the NICE guidelines recommend the LARC methods very, very strongly. ACOG also does, and FOXI also does. So there is a complete concordance by all statutory authorities on LARC, and injectable contraceptives today are performing extremely well in the public sector. And in the private sector, we are seeing a slightly refined version of the subcutaneous DMPA. I'll come to it. The contraceptive benefits of DMPA: safe, effective, convenient, easy, reversible, 7 to 10 months max for return of fertility, private and confidential method, does not interfere with sex, pelvic exam not required, women who cannot use estrogen can be given, breastfeeding women can be given, immediate postpartum in non-breastfeeding women it can be given, post-abortion it can be started immediately, both in first and second trimester, immediate injection before she goes home, may be used by women in any age, any parity. That is the beauty of injectable. Well, what are the limitations? Does not protect against infections. Of course, you have to combine it with barrier. Once taken, action cannot be reversed. Of course, has to be repeated every 12 weeks. Return of fertility, 10 months, I told. And few conditions, liver dysfunction, breast cancer, history of it. With less than 5 years of remission, thromboembolic disorders, poorly controlled hypertension and cardiovascular risk. But well-controlled hypertension is okay. I'll come to that. Subcutaneous, 30% lower dosage. Okay, not expensive at all, quite cost-effective. In 40 countries, it has been approved. DCGI also has approved. And it contains 104 milligrams. It is self-injectable, very simple to inject, requires only one training, and it is very eco-friendly. So all the features are there. And therefore, it is very suitable, very important tool for self-care in contraception. and very important, method which can be prescribed over a teleconsultation platform. So it offers women with highly effective, convenient, long-acting with a tolerability profile that may be better than that of DMPA IM. We don't yet know that. The needle is certainly smaller, that much I can tell you. We come to the Mirena. Of course, this is the gynecologist's best friend and also the woman's best friend. And we all know about Mirena. I will not, the LNG IUS, I do not wish to take time away for that. The only thing is contraindications is undiagnosed bleeding or gestational trophoblastic disease or sepsis or cancers or distorted cavity or chronic infections or tuberculosis or active infection of the cervix or active STIs. Relative or postpartum between 48 hours and 4 weeks. We know that holds good for PPI UCD as well. DVT is relative actually, and other cancers are relative. Okay, so LNG IUS has got a beautiful, beautiful, spectrum of benefit for the woman in different types of AUBs, also contraception, also menopausal hormonal therapy. Everybody knows that. Is it the best LARC then? Because it can be used at different reproductive stages. For example, a 30-year-old not comfortable with tablets, middle class lady, 40-year-old, not tubectomized, with HMB and anemia, someone who wants sterilization but does not want surgery, someone who is counseled for PPFP, goes away from the hospital after delivery, she can come back and get this inserted. Also, a girl who is barely agreeing for the condom used by the partner and does not want marriage and babies ever. So even in adolescent, it can be used very well and it can be the answer. And it has some better safety profile and better effect on the menstruation. We know that as compared to the copper IUCD. And of course, it also kind of protects against anemia, but does not protect against STIs. So there goes the continuation rate of different methods. And we can see that hormonal IUD have the best continuation rate. Okay, so LARC after abortion has also got a distinct place. I don't think I should be going through this slide. We come to the implant. Subdermal, LARC, 3 years, applicator available. It is radio opaque today. The non-radio opaque is in 17 countries, clinical trials. Radio opaque has in 6 countries, clinical trials, 4 centimeter long, 2 millimeter wide. And good analogy is that it is like a matchstick. The core is ethylene vinyl acetate copolymer surrounded by the drug, which acts as the rate controlling membrane. Very, very steady release of the drug over 3 years, a single use applicator. And efficacy, highly efficacious, 99%, and consistent level of etanogestrel. I need not say that. Of course, it acts like this, ovulation inhibition and cervical mucus. And of course, there are some adverse events. It's not possible to have nil adverse events. About 5% of women suffer from headache and sometimes from menstrual disturbances. With counseling, it is actually quite okay. It is quite okay. Complications of insertion and removal can be a challenge, but with good training and with the currently available applicator, it's very, very user-friendly and it should not happen. Rarely there can be paresthesia or hematoma or sometimes migration if the insertion site is not understood properly and deep insertions are happening, then it can. Contraindication, of course, if there is an active DVT or a sex steroid sensitive malignancy, we cannot put this in. If there is liver problem, we cannot do that. If there is undiagnosed vaginal bleeding, don't use the implant. First diagnose the vaginal bleeding, then you can give it. Hypersensitivity to the active substance. Some drug interactions. This is one place where the injectable scores over the implant. Injectables do not have much of drug interaction, but this drug, etanogestrel, behaves a little bit like the combined hormonal contraceptives and interacts with all the liver enzyme inducers, the cytochrome P450 inducers, and its efficacy may come down when a woman is on anticonvulsants or antiretroviral medication. Okay, so in those women, we have to be cautious about using this very simple tray required for insertion, very simple anatomical identification of the site of insertion, 8 to 10 centimeter from the medial epicondyle. And I must go forward with this as requested by Dr. Maninder. I hope everybody can see the video being played. Yeah, and I hope it is heard also. I'm not sure about the audio though. Okay, so this is the point which is first identified and painted, and a very small dose of anesthetic is given, about 2 ml of 2% xylocaine, and a wheal is raised there. It does not require an incision because the needle is sharp enough, and we remove it from the its package, and we hold it very, very carefully, because if we push the slider before time, then the whole device gets discharged. That is the only trick to be remembered, at a 45 degree angle. And once the bevel of the needle is below the skin, we lower it to become parallel and lift up the skin, lower the applicator to horizontal, and then advance it till the entire needle goes in. And it just goes like knife through butter. It is very, very simple and very comfortable for the woman, because you would have anesthetized the track of 4 to 5 centimeter, and then you depress the purple slider, and that releases the device just underneath the skin. And that is all there is to the insertion site. You just bandage it up and tell her to remove it after 24 to 48 hours. Okay, so that is about it. And if the woman comes for removal, it is also easy. First and foremost, we have to identify the device. It should be, you know, palpable well, and you should be able to see the distal tip of the device. And that is where you will give a very small anesthetic injection of 1 ml below the tip of the device. So if you give it below the tip of the device, gets elevated, and then you can give an injection on an incision, a tiny, tiny incision on the tip of the device, and go on teasing the tissue there till the device makes its appearance into your incision, and then you can just pull it out. So removal is also fairly quite technically okay. Only mandatory thing is there is formal training required. So MEC category 3, I think I have mentioned, very few contraindications and no restriction for women living with HIV actually. But if they are on drugs, also can be generally used, but a little fine tuning is required. So implants in special situations like enzyme inducing drugs, we can advise a switch off method. Obesity, maybe earlier replacement. Migraine, it can be used 1 and 2. This is from Cochrane review. No statistically significant increase in these deadly vascular complications like COCs. Okay. There's no decrease in BMD, and actually more research may be required. So safety of progestins for women with medical conditions, I will be ending with the last few slides. For example, in obesity, in type 2 diabetes mellitus and cardiovascular risk factors, we need to apply the MEC criteria with a lot of fine tuning. Let us look at safety in hypertension. POP, LNG, IUS and implants usually are clubbed together, as you saw in the postpartum chart also. These three are usually clubbed together, and injectables have a slightly different safety profile. So POP, these three things, in adequately controlled hypertension, or mildly elevated BPs, it is category 1. If there is history of hypertension, if BP cannot be evaluated like over a teleconsultation, or if there is severe hypertension also, these can be used with MEC category 2. So even severe hypertension is not a contraindication for these, but for injectables, it is category 3. And in women with history of hypertension or adequately controlled, it is category 2, not category 1 like the other progestins. We go on to DM. So POPs have almost no effect on the glycemic control, category 2. Benefit of LNG implant outweigh the risk in DM, both with and without vascular complications. So can you see the versatility of POP, LNG and etanodestrin? Even with diabetes with vascular complication, category 2, you can prescribe injectable in without vascular complication. DM is category 2, but the safety, but if it is there are vascular complication, then injectable becomes category 3, because the risk will outweigh the benefit. So the women with vascular complication or who have had the disease for more than 20 years do not prescribe injectables based on theoretically increased cardiovascular risk in these women if they are using DMPs. So you avoid. What about apply SLE thrombocytopenia? Apply SLE thrombocytopenia are at high risk of VT and WHO category 3 for all these methods. severe thrombocytopenia, they can be given category 2 with the exception of DMPA, because that can cause the potential for irregular bleeding. And what about hereditary thrombophilias? No, progesterone only methods are category 2. Women on anticoagulant therapy, for example, with prosthetic valve or VT in the past, again, category 2. There is a study example of a study of 13 women of chronic anticoagulation with warfarin who were hospitalized for hemorrhagic ovarian cysts. And they were all receiving DMPA to prevent ovulation and to, you know, regress these ovarian cysts, and also for contraception. And a study period of 3 years, they were quite fine. There was no problem. Neurological problems, stroke, headache, migraine. So even with women with aura, without aura or non-migraine headache for initiating the method, in women with migraine with aura also, all these methods are category 2. Without aura or non-migraine headache, it is category 1. And the safety tip is any new headache or change in headache characteristic, it warrants evaluation. Just like in CHC, you have to evaluate any new onset headache. Study example, 15-year Danish study, no increase in stroke risk in women who have used norethindrone, LNG IUD or implant, compared to women using no contraception. So there is no increase in stroke in women who are using progesterone only. So I end by saying that condition associated with increased risk of adverse health event as a result of unintended pregnancy, LARC methods, especially the progesterone ones, are very, very useful, except for few. We can use LARC methods in breast cancer. Copper T can be used, of course, here, not the progesterone only in the second one. Heart disease, we can use progesterones also. Diabetes, I have told you. Some cancers also. Sickle cell disease, it can be used, especially the Depo Provera has got a beneficial effect on sicklers. Epilepsy also, it can be used. In infections, hypertension, I have spoken of. HIV, I have spoken of. Thrombogenic mutations and malignant GTT, all have been covered. So, sorry about the, I'm not getting the slide to go forward. Okay, an annual increase of 0.4% was thought in the last year as FP 2020 commitment. And I do not know whether this was achieved, probably not. MCPR of 54.3, do you know the MCPR needed to rise from 53.9% to 54.3% with FP 2020? To some extent, it might have been achieved. But what we are looking at now is FP 2030, and country commitment is building up for that. And I'm sure we will all participate in that. Rolling out of newer contraceptives and a 360 degree approach is what it is called. The furthest, the hardest to reach rural and urban areas should be covered by contraception. I would like to save this before signing off. This is the UN endorsement of 13 life-saving commodities way back 2012. Reproductive health, maternal health. Let me say maternal health first so that you get orientation. Oxytocin is life-saving. Misoprostol is life-saving. And magnesium sulfate is life-saving. Reproductive health, female condom, contraceptive implant, emergency contraception. These are life-saving tools. Let us remember, family planning alone could bring more benefits to more people at less cost than any other single technology now available to the human race. Let us create a world without unintended pregnancies. Two negatives there, okay? Without unintended. I leave you with this image in your mind, ladies and gentlemen. How dark is your country? How dark? It is actually the darkest looking. Probably one tiny country, Montana and Northern Europe, is darker than our country. That is hardly any credit for us. And we are as dark as Bangladesh. So here I am signing off. Thank you very much, Maninderji. I really enjoyed addressing the August audience. Thanks a lot. Thank you.
Dr. Shobha, I don't know what to say. That's what I introduced you, you know. I thought we had a basket of contraceptive options, but you got a basket of progesterone only option. And as I told you, people are going to start using contraception as a progesterone only. You know, OC, yes, COC, yes, but we have a very good option in the progesterone only, and I'm sure, especially with lactating moment and LNG, decreasing the blood flow is going to make a lot of difference in the woman's health. Thank you very much, Dr. Shobha. As expected, you are great, you are wonderful, and I'm sure people really enjoyed this thing. Thank you very much. Over to Maninder and Sneha.
Thank you, Dr. Shobha. I think that was a wonderful talk, and the points to be carried forward from the dark to the lighter. That is what we need. And I'm thankful to you because I know you are not well. You had some problem with your dentures and all that, but even then you made it possible. I was wondering how you will keep it up. So that is very, very good that unintended pregnancies, which are 9 out of 10, they have to look into. But very important point which you have talked, which we'll be discussing later on in our discussions also, that these charts, they should be available. They should be on our table all the time. Because sometimes when the patients come with different conditions, we are not able to remember that immediately. And that gives a negative feedback to the patient. I think it's a very, very good idea that for the future, we should have made these charts available. And we can, of course, ask our pharma companies when they are giving us complimentary things which we don't need at all. They should be giving these charts. Or the second thing, Shobha, which we can do now, because it's an era of AI now, artificial intelligence, and moving ahead with the digital world. So please, can you just do one thing, send them on to us. We'll be putting them not on the website, but on the mobiles of everybody in the WhatsApp group. They can download and keep it on their mobiles. Because these are the things which are really required. When we come see practically, I know patients came to me, progesterone only pill after postpartum, but in a hurry, I was not able to communicate with them completely as I wanted to. So these charts are a very good idea. And if physically okay on your table, not at least let's have them on our mobiles at least. Yes.
Yeah.
So thank you very good. You. And please stay on because we
I am here. Yeah.
Dr. Shaila, please for our second speaker.
Shobha ma'am, and thank you so much. Deepak sir, thank you so much, Maninder ma'am. So moving ahead to the next topic, can we have the slides displayed? Yes. Indeed a pleasure to take such a big name on this platform. Dr. Meenakshi B. Chauhan. Ma'am is Professor of Obstetrics and Gynecology at Pandit B.D. Sharma PGIMS Rohtak Institute. She holds an awesome experience of more than 30 years in the field of obs and gyne, Master Trainers of MOC, Ex-Secretary and Vice President of Rohtak Branch of OXI, Don's Award for Best Paper at AICOG at Agra in January 2004, Dr. A.N. Dan's Award for Best Paper at AICOG Guwahati 2010, and so many other best paper presentations and awards, more than 100 publications, authored many chapters, faculty in various national and international conferences. And her areas of special interest are endoscopy, high-risk pregnancy, and oncology. And ma'am, it's a privilege to have you on this platform. And the dice belongs to you now to introduce our next speaker and the topic as well.
थैंक यू बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद डॉक्टर शैला सभी वरिष्ठ जनों व साथियों को नमस्कार मेरा सबसे पहले मैं डॉक्टर मनिंदर आहूजा का आभार व्यक्त करना चाहूंगी और उनको बधाई देना चाहूंगी जिन्होंने इस बहुत ही महत्वपूर्ण समस्या पर आज मंथन करने का विचार रखा है सिंस कॉन्ट्रासेप्शन चॉइसेस ड्यूरिंग पेरीमेनोपॉजल फेज आर लिमिटेड and difficult from different from young women as many women have comorbidities and we have to look for the side effects the risk factors and other non-contraceptive benefits also when we consider contraceptive choices in perimenopause so it is a very important topic and at the same time there are increased risk of unwanted pregnancy during perimenopause because usually the women think that they underestimate their fertility at this age. So a very important topic has been selected. So for this, may I invite Dr. Parag Binivale. He doesn't need any introduction as such. He's such a good orator. He's our senior consultant at Pune. He has been a PG teacher and unit head at Kamala Nehru Hospital. and he is currently vice chairperson of ICOG, a very prestigious position. He had been the president of Menopause Society and president-elect for Pune OBGY Society. And also, he has taken up the positions of as secretary for ICOG and has been national website editor, peer review for our Jogi Chairman Young Talent Promotion Committee, and he has co-edited many books and delivered many lectures, we all of us know, and has been a recipient of Dr. C.S. Dawn Prize. So, Dr. Parag Binivale, he is going to talk on contraceptive choices in perimenopause, which is really a difficult decision to make.
Thank you, Dr. Meenakshi. Good evening all, and I bring greetings from Pune. At the outset, let me thank Dr. Maninder and team AOGD, Kavita, Shaila, and everybody for asking me to talk on contraceptive choices in perimenopausal women. I became member of Family Welfare Committee way back in 2001. So that was how my interest in family welfare started. And I had the pleasure of working with all the chairpersons, right from Dr. D. Pushpalata till Shobha Godi. Of course, Dr. Basab also was the chairperson with whom I have worked. I'm going to talk about a very special population as far as contraception is concerned, and that is women who are in their perimenopause. And at the same time, we have to remember that fertility often falls in perimenopause. We know that it is not really easy for a 40 or a 45-year-old woman to become pregnant. But of course, we do not want to land up in the badhai ho situation. So all we want for our women is that they use an effective, safe, and appropriate method of birth control until menopause is confirmed so that they do not become pregnant at midlife when they really don't want to. So when we are dealing with a woman who comes to us who is in the midlife and wants advice regarding contraception, the first question that we ask her is whether she has any intention of conceiving in the near future or a distant future. Very important history about medical disorders, diabetes mellitus, hypertension, cardiovascular disease, history of venous thromboembolism in the past. Now, these medical disorders will guide us as to what contraceptive choices we should offer. History of smoking is important because if the lady is a smoker, if she's smoking about 15 to 20 cigarettes a day, which is not an unusual thing, we must note here, then the choices would be limited. Sexual history is important. The frequency, any issues that she's facing because of the hormonal changes must be noted. We must examine, do necessary screening for various neoplasia. We must ask them about their past contraceptive experiences because once she's in midlife, we are sure that the lady must have used some kind of contraception in the past, and whether she was happy with whatever she has used in the past, and very, very importantly, the woman's wish, what she wants. There are certain difficulties, of course. We know that natural family planning, the rhythm method, etc., are not recommended in these women because we know that their periods are irregular. We do not know whether they are ovulating or when they are ovulating. So it's better to refrain from natural family planning methods. Emergency contraception is something which is available as a backup, and we all will agree that it should not be promoted as a regular birth control method. And of course, the medical disorders which make choices rather limited in these women. And when we talk about choices, we know that we have a big basket of contraceptives, and this basket is ever increasing. We have some things like the permanent method, the intrauterine devices, or the implants, which are very, very effective as compared to the male condoms, fertility awareness based methods, etc., which are definitely less effective. So let's start with the permanent ones, because many a time these women come to us for a permanent sterilization. And when we think about permanent sterilization, of course, we can give them two options. The better option of the two is the vasectomy. And when we think of no scalpel vasectomy, we know that it's an OPD procedure. When the client walks in the OT and walks out, it's a matter of 10 minutes. There are special instruments required. No stitches are required, but some kind of contraception has to continue for 3 months. Do a semen analysis after 3 months and ensure that there is azoospermia. Wherein the tubal ligation is rather more tedious, I should say. We can do it by an open method or a laparoscopic method. It has to be done under suitable anesthesia. Sialistic bands are used for laparoscopic sterilization. And of course, it can be a challenge, especially in women who are obese, who've had previous gynecological surgeries, or those who have some of the pelvic pathologies. And of course, the other challenges that we must understand as far as female sterilization is concerned is that it is a major procedure. You're putting a scope inside the abdomen or you're opening the abdomen. So anesthesia is definitely required. And there is a possibility of menstrual abnormalities in the future. And there, the literature also supports that women who undergo tubal sterilization are at increased risk of landing in hysterectomy. Wherein male contraceptive, or we know that the participation of the male in general is poor, and the basic myth, which definitely is a deterrent and which has to be dispelled, is the impact on sexuality. So when we compare the various methods, we know that there are long-acting reversible contraceptives, about which Shobha has talked in details, are as safe, as effective, and probably less invasive as contraceptive options. Coming to the temporary ones, and I'm going to talk only about the intrauterine devices, injectables, and implants specifically. Coming to intrauterine devices are the most commonly used methods of reversible contraception worldwide, used in about 23% women. We know that it is highly efficacious, safe, easy to use, and it is cost effective. It provides a non-surgical option for prevention of pregnancy, which is as effective as surgical sterilization. And of course, we are using copper as well as hormonal intrauterine devices. There are certain benefits which are so important, especially in women who are in the midlife. Now, here we are offering them something which is highly effective. It does not require regular adherence from user to maintain high effectiveness. It is long acting, 3, 5, 10, extendable to 12 to 13 years is what we are looking at. It is rapidly reversible, especially if the woman makes changes her mind and wants to conceive. There are fewer medical contraindications for intrauterine devices, fewer side effects, and of course, it does not interfere with the spontaneity of sex. Of course, it also has some risk reduction as far as the cervical, endometrium, and ovarian cancer are concerned. There are quite a few studies which support this, and I think we should also promote this method in women who are in the perimenopause. Of course, there are certain challenges when we are talking about a copper intrauterine device. We know that the menses could be heavier, they could be longer, more painful, especially in the first 3 or 4 cycles. There are certain myths, again, which we need to dispel as about weight gain and medical disorders caused by copper intrauterine devices. Malposition, pain, irregular bleeding is a challenge at times, but then we need to basically deal with some problems like expulsion, not a very common occurrence. Pelvic inflammation, we do not expect any IUD to produce a PID, but yes, correct selection is important. And the perforation is, again, a very, very rare occurrence. Coming to LNG-IUS as contraceptive. The beauty of LNG-IUS is it combines the advantages of OCPILs, that is high efficacy, reduction in menstrual loss, and reduction in chances of pelvic inflammatory disease with an intrauterine device. where daily motivation is not required, it is long acting, it is rapidly reversible, and it is estrogen free. So probably a perfect choice for a woman who is on the verge of menopause, where the hormones go for a toss, the periods become erratic, they become heavy at times. Of course, we need to investigate why it is so, and then offer them LNG intrauterine system, which will take them through the stormy or hormonally stormy period of perimenopause. We know that this is one of the important LARCs, which was used as contraceptive, but it can also be used for treatment of heavy menstrual bleeding. How the LNG IUS acts? We know that it does have an impact on the endometrium. It causes thinning of endometrium. Of course, it is also responsible for thickening the cervical mucus and prevent the pregnancy. When can we insert it? Typically within 7 days of onset of menstrual bleeding. It can be replaced by a new system after the first device expires. Follow-up is important. We should ask women to report for first follow-up after 4 to 12 weeks, then 12 months after insertion, and thereafter once a year or whenever the client faces any problem. The side effects are something which we must keep in mind and counsel women that irregular or unscheduled bleeding is something which may bother them for first 3 or 4 months. Amenorrhea is probably a desired side effect, and especially women who are troubled by heavy menstrual bleeding would be very happy if they become amenorrheic. Embedment, perforation are quite rare, but have to be kept in mind. Whenever the client wants, we can remove the device or we can remove it after 5 years. Please note that there are some studies which do mention same efficacy of LNG intrauterine system as a contraceptive up to 7 years. So you can counsel the patient and remove it whenever she desires, and removal is easy. You just need to pull the thread out. So whenever we are thinking about women in perimenopause, these are some of the important points we want to know, because we would like to know its safety. So LNG use appears to have no clinically relevant effect on bone mineral density, no effect on cardiovascular risk markers like blood pressure or lipid metabolism, metabolic parameters like glucose tolerance or liver function. It does not have any impact on the vaginal flora or cervical cytology. And there is no association with an increased risk of breast cancer. And it also has a neutral effect on sexual function. Coming to the COCs, and we know that the choice of oral contraception in women at midlife should be taken into account, because there are climacteric symptoms, there are bleeding patterns which are altered, and of course bone protection also has to be kept in mind. So there are certain benefits in women who are in midlife. COCs will have an impact on the bone mineral density, and there would be a certain rise. 50% reduction in the risk of ovarian and endometrial cancers, which continues for 15 years after stopping. So a great benefit to these perimenopausal women. Reduction in the risk of colorectal cancer, reduction in the incidence of benign breast disease, reduction of menstrual bleeding and pain, and of course, those women who are suffering from vasomotor symptoms will certainly get some amount of relief with combined oral contraceptive pills. Of course, there are certain issues, especially in these age groups, which we have to keep in mind. There is a relative risk of thromboembolism, which can increase up to 5-fold. So this is something which we must keep at the back of our mind. A very small increase in absolute risk of ischemic stroke, but there is no increase in the hemorrhagic stroke. As far as the breast cancer is concerned, there is slight increase in the risk, but it is reduced to no excess risk 10 years after stopping. So this is, again, one point for counseling in these particular women. And when we are talking about cervical cancer, there is increased risk of cervical cancer and CIN after 5 years of use of COCs. There are certain issues that we must remember, that it should not be given to non-smokers at any age with no specific risk factors have no increased risk of myocardial infarction with COC use. Women who are more than 35 years with no other risk factors who have stopped smoking more than a year ago. And there are certain contraindications where the risk of using COCs outweigh the benefits for smokers above 35 years and women who are over 40 with cardiovascular disease, stroke, or migraine, where we should not use COCs. Coming to DMPA, Shobha has already talked about it in detail. There is no age limit for DMPA use. Women can safely continue DMPA injections until they become menopausal. As a long-term DMPA users have high rates of amenorrhea, perimenopausal users may not experience the irregular bleeding that is a characteristic in perimenopause, in perimenopausal transition. Likewise, such women may not experience vasomotor symptoms because they are suppressed by DMPA use. And when we talk about DMPA, we are always concerned about bone mineral density. Yes, DMPA users have lower bone density than non-users, but here we must remember that once the woman discontinues DMPA, the BMD issue is not a major one. Coming to POPs, we know that compared to progestin-only pills, DMPA has higher contraceptive efficacy, where the typical use of unintended pregnancy rates are 4 versus 9%. Ease of dosing every 13 weeks compared to daily dosing, because remembering taking a pill is a challenge at times, especially in a working woman in her midlife. And of course, slower return to fertility is something which we have to remember. Etanogestrel implants, Shobha has already talked about it, but here we must and we should understand that compared with the etanogestrel implant, some users may find that DMPA is more private in that the implant's rods can sometimes be felt, and in fact, the implant may be little visible. Of course, we know that with 1 year of continued use, amenorrhea will be achieved in approximately 50% of DMPA users as compared to 20% users of etanogestrel implants. Coming to the safety of progestin-only contraceptives, we know that cardiovascular and cerebrovascular disease, there is no risk in CVD, myocardial infarction, venous thromboembolism, or stroke. Breast cancer, there's no significant increase in the risk of breast cancer with POPs and injectables. The use of implants and LNG IUS are unlikely to pose an increased risk. Long-term use of progestin-only contraception is associated with a reduction of BMD, but we have already talked about it and we should not worry too much about it. But if a woman has current venous thromboembolism, or if she has a history of ischemic heart disease or stroke, we should refrain from using progestin-only contraceptive. The challenge in this age group is stopping contraceptives. So we know that the average age of menopause in our country is about 46 or 47, thanks to Dr. Maninder, who did the first research for the Indian Menopause Society. We must understand that at the age of 54 years, as most of the women will be menopausal by this age, why 55? It is the definition of delayed menopause. Measuring FSH levels on two occasions, 1 to 2 months apart, may predict ovarian failure. But again, we have to counsel the patient or the client before talking about it. Now, when we want to stop non-hormonal contraceptive, we can wait till the lady is amenorrheic for 1 year or 2 years, especially if she's less than 50. And IUD with more than 300 millimeter square of copper inserted at the age of more than 40 is retained until the woman becomes menopausal. As far as the hormonal contraceptions are concerned, because we know that amenorrhea is not reliable because we are not in a position to differentiate whether it is the effect of the contraceptive or it is effect of the ovaries that have failed at because of the age. And women using combined contraception should be advised to switch to another suitable method at the age of 50 years. And FSH in these women is not a reliable indicator. There are some special situations because we tend to use menopausal hormone therapy in perimenopausal women to alleviate the symptoms. But here we must tell the woman that a combined MHT cannot be advised to rely on this as contraceptive. So if she wants contraceptive, she has to use something else. POP can be used with MHT to provide effective contraception, and women using estrogen replacement therapy may consider this as a contraceptive. Now, coming to follow-up, which is really important, frequent follow-ups are required for women who are on COCs. Women who are above the age of 40 should be advised to return for follow-up whenever they develop any problem. And this has been a challenge for last 1.5 years in the COVID times, because clients are reluctant to do a follow-up in a busy OPD. I will end my presentation by showing some important slides, because this talks about the medical eligibility criteria, how in which we should be using combined OCs or POPs. I think MEC WHO 2015 is an important document because it will tell us whether which contraceptive is suitable if there is a risk factor like DVT or pulmonary embolism, or if woman is obese or hyperlipidemic. And similarly, women who come to us with bleeding or unexplained vaginal bleeding, or women who have endometriosis. And of course, headache is one common problem where we would be a bit hesitant using a combined oral contraceptive pills. And to conclude, family planning represents a key component of reproductive health care. The risk of pregnancy is decreased but not trivial among women over 40 years of age. So whenever they desire, good contraceptive choices have to be offered. Evidence-based guidelines for contraceptive use can assist clinicians in counseling these patients, because key to success of a useful or effective contraception is good counseling. Intrauterine contraceptive is one of the most effective methods, effective as well as safe in midlife. Progestin-only contraception is another safe option for women in midlife. COCs can be safely used by midlife women who do not have a cardiovascular risk factor. Non-contraceptive benefits for this population include improvement in abnormal uterine bleeding, decreased hot flashes, and the decreased cancer risk. And contraception can be used by a midlife woman without medical contraindications until the age of menopause, because at which time they may consider transition to systemic hormone therapy. So once again, thank you very much, Maninder and AOGD, for the invitation.
Thanks a lot, Dr. Binivala, for summarizing this difficult topic in this short period of time and making the choices very clear. So finally, in perimenopause, I would say that POPs, which Dr. Shobha Gurdi have already talked, is very important now, and especially LARCs, so the long-acting reversible contraceptives, and Dr. Shobha has already highlighted also. DMP is a good choice. Now the age of menopause is also increasing, even in our country. So DMP, I should say, I think after 50 years, especially DMP may be avoided, because as Dr. Vinewala already said, there is it decreases the bone mineral density, though they say that with long-term use, it is not significant. And especially about OCs. So normally we were not using COCs. We can use COCs at least till 50. There are no high risk factors. But if the ethinyl estradiol component is less than 30 microgram, those COCs must preferably be used, I will say. And another simple point, our chaya, our Indian drug, Again, it can also be used till 50 with the same side effects. So very wonderful talk, Dr. Binewala. Thank you so much. You have cleared
thank
the choice.
Thank you, Dr. Parag. Badhaiyo. How many of you have seen that Hindi movie, Badhaiyo?
Middle
aged woman gets pregnant.
Yeah, that's so, why I said that usually the ladies underestimate their fertility potential and the frequency of intercourse also becomes less. So they are just like, don't think about contraception many times.
Yes.
But it is very important.
So fertility decreases, but it's very embarrassing.
That's
why, right, I took this age group also, because if we just go on concentrating adolescent health only, which me and Prague started our journey together, he was already in FOXI. He was a trainer, master trainer for adolescent health. And we had that wonderful session. I think, Parag, I am never going to forget that training session. And even you remember that.
Of course. 2006.
Yeah. So we started our journey here. And when I came into Menopause Society, he followed me here and he became the president of the Pune Menopause Society. And now he's working so actively as secretary of the ICOG. Parag, you are not only a close friend of mine. I mean, you are really very dear to me and you know it. Whenever I have any problem anywhere, I'll send him a message. He'll tell me it doesn't matter. I know it doesn't matter, but I have to talk to you. So that matters to me. So it was a wonderful session. And Badhaiyo, I said, just not because of that issue also, but Badhaiyo, because you have covered it so nicely. And I'm so proud of you that you have learned about the menopause in such details and you could talk about the menopause contraception so effectively. Yes, partnership of
thank
male
you, Maninder,
not there. Male, how to involve the male in the contraception process is what we'll be taking again in our discussion. And is your problem of at home, Pooja is there? You will be staying on there or not?
I have to go for Ganpati Visarjan. If I come back early, I'll
then you will come back.
Yes, I'll
try
join.
To come back. Okay. Yeah. Thank you very much for being
thank you,
here.
Maninder.
I'm really, really grateful for contributing in such an effective way about the contraception in the midlife.
Yeah. Thank you, Maninder.
And thank you, Dr. Meenakshi Chauhan. You have, summarized it so well. But please be there till the end because we'll be
sure.
Needing more discussions and more input from your end.
Thank you. Thank you.
Our next speaker, I think I'll have introduced Dr. Prateek Tambe, who will be next chairperson. Dr. Prateek Tambe, whatever he has been doing in organizations, he's an RT consultant and gynae endoscopic surgeon, that apart, I have seen his dedication and his real hard work for these institutions. Because I was there with him in ISAR also, in FOXI also, and at so many platforms, he was doing work and managing the conferences in a very diligent and, I mean, very, very honestly. So that impressed me a lot. And I've been feeling very close to him that he's one of those persons whom our institutions and organizations, they do need persons like him who are really committed. Besides, I think I'll just hurry through his CV, whatever is there, that he was chairperson of the MOGS Endocrinology Committee, governing council member of ICOG, executive member. I told you, he has been there in so many organizations, IAG, MSR, ISAR, FOXI, MOGS, and he got so many awards also. But awards are what we feel about them. So I never go for the awards. I go for the people who have been effectively working for the organization, not just for the heck of doing it, but having an imprint on these organizations. And Prateek Tambe, I think it's an honor that you have accepted my invitation. Besides, you're so busy schedule, I know you people have become more busy now because of this. And of course, he has so many publications. I'm leaving all those things that he is an effective, our leadership quality in him for various organizations he has been working on. Prateek, welcome to you. And you have to introduce our young champion, another young champion, Shaila Jamal. So it's an honor to have you. Prateek, over to you now.
Thank you so much, respected Dr. Maninder Ahuja, ma'am. It's a pleasure and a privilege to be with all of you. And I was there listening in the background to two fantastic speakers, Dr. Shubha Gudi, chairperson of the Family Welfare Committee, and a dear friend, Parag, who covered two wonderful topics in such excellent detail. For most of us, contraception is such a boring topic. You know, we don't really study it much. In practice, we just totally ignore it. We never even offer choices to patients, to be very honest. And to have a full program on contraception with such excellent faculty, hats off to SMLM and the AOGD, specifically Dr. Maninder Ahuja. To introduce the next speaker, we have a very young, dynamic and vivacious Dr. Shaila Jamal. She is an associate professor from Bareilly. She is also the founder and president of the Society of Menstrual Disorders and Hygiene Management. She has served various different organizations. She is currently the North Zone in charge of the Young Talent Promotion Committee of FOCSI. She's also a coordinator for the FOCSI Endocrinology Committee. She's a member of two more committees, the Academic Exchange and the Breast Committee of FOCSI. She's a core committee member of RNTEP, and she has innumerable awards to her credit at this young age. Just to name a few, she's one of the FOCSI Leaders of Tomorrow. She's also won the FOCSI TAC Award. She's had an award from the WHO as well, several publications to her credit. She's a social activist and a writer. She feels very passionately about menstrual hygiene. Over to Dr. Shaila Jamal to elucidate the different contraception conundrums in COVID-19 pandemic. I think this is one of the issues which all of us must have faced throughout the lockdown period and in the pandemic, that women are unfortunately getting pregnant because they don't have access to good contraception services. And as I said, sometimes the fault lies with us because we don't go out of our way to offer these choices and offer appropriate advice to our patients. Over to you, Dr. Shaila.
Thank you so much, sir. And thank you so much, Maninder ma'am, for giving me this opportunity to talk about contraception, COVID and conundrums. So we had to put certain breaks at certain point of life. So today we'll be discussing the damage done that was brought about by COVID-19 pandemic, COVID diaries we did when we were actually suffering from COVID. We were seeing patients, we were locking them up, we were quarantining them. And yes, to dissect the ongoing needs that we need to look into, and we will be discussing some of the challenges in our roundtable discussion today also. So with this, a word about displacement and disaster obstetricians and gynecologists. We faced classic 3 DDs, that is antenatal care, institutional delivery, and family planning consultations. All three came down drastically. And thus, the opportunities to counsel about contraceptive choices, as Prateek sir has just highlighted, that counseling is very, very important. We lost the opportunities. UNFPA estimated in February 2021, then, that if lockdowns are not removed, if the conditions are continuing in the same pace, many of countries will run out their contraceptive supplies within 6 months. The impact was magnanimous. There was 10% decline over the course of a year in the use of contraception due to stockouts, unavailable providers, closed clinics, and physicians' hesitancy as well. 48 million women would have an unmet need for contraception. 15 million additional unintended pregnancies will be faced by us. 1 million, close to 2 million, will be experiencing major obstetric complications without care. And this was the thing we were working for bringing down since last 2 or 3 decades. And 3 million additional women will be resorting to unsafe abortion. Such a big challenge. In India, COVID-19 pandemic, it was proven, it was published that access to contraceptive choices for more than 25 million couples came down. And this was a report released by UNAIDS. Our backbone of such programs, ASHA workers, they were overburdened. And they said that lack of access to contraceptives was a big and major issue, and the services were broken down. Permanent methods like sterilization also suffered a setback. Why I said permanent methods? Because still they are quite a favorite one, especially in rural population. We had to do a lot of work to counsel them to make them realize that this is such a good choice. But with COVID-19 pandemic, the break put by it, it again suffered a huge setback. Apart from this, they needed to undergo RT-PCR or rapid antigen test before visiting healthcare facility. And they believe that if they got it done, they will be turning out positive. And if they are turning out positive, they will be quarantined. And thus, they will have to skip work already. Earning bread, and I will not say butter, earning bread was a major issue, which would have brought a lot of distress to the family. So starting from here, reaching till here, we were doing a wonderful job. We were actually reaching to the people where we should have been. But when the situation was like this, people were facing a lot of problem to sustain their lives, to work and walk from one place to another. Talking of contraception was a backseat or was a secondary choice, was a secondary topic of conversation amongst us. 2020 data said that overall adverse impact on family planning program in 2020 is estimated to be between -15% to -23%. So we lost 1/4 of our program efforts in 2020. And when the severity of lockdown and COVID pandemic was more severe, I think it was 5 to 10 times more severe than the first wave, we are still awaiting this 2021 data. Although we are recuperating, but what is the rate of that recovery, we are still not knowing. All were locked in our houses, stocks were finishing up, and OCPs, emergency contraceptive pills, none of the other contraceptive commodities were listed in essential things that were to be transferred or that could have been delivered to our doorsteps. Method-wise, loss of contraceptive services, huge suffer was lost. Even condoms saw a decline from 342 million to 500.56 million, along with oral contraceptive pills. And as said earlier, male and female sterilizations were already going down. So what did we do? We did educational activities, and they are still going on. We did webinars. NMC also set certain relaxations for teleconsultation. But did we actually reach the place where we should have been, where it is needed the most? Answer is probably a query. Second situation came when people were suffering from COVID, whether they were at their homes or they were hospitalized. Concerns on hormonal contraception was a big issue. Drug interactions were making concerns. LARC, those who were already using them, especially DIMPA, they were having serious doubts about the efficacies of the drugs that will be delivered to them, or some effects that they may have because of LARC and COVID-related medications or COVID virus itself. So first concern came with CHC, that is combined hormonal contraception. D-dimer was a big champion at this time, I will say. There were a lot of thromboembolic events which were causative for a fatality in COVID-19 positive cases. We were seeing elevated levels in COVID, and they were serving as prognostic markers everywhere. Thus came up several reports where it was seen that combined oral contraceptive users had elevated D-dimers during COVID-19 when they were suffering from it, and even after that. Certain guidelines, this particular online website is claiming to reach to more than 100 million viewers. And they released this sort of alarm that birth control pills can increase a person's risk of blood clots by 3 or 4-fold, and COVID-19 may further exacerbate that risk. Various papers, those estimated thromboembolic events, contraception, even MHT during COVID-19 also raised this kind of alarm. So what was the result of this? Symptomatic and hospitalized patients, they right away discontinued. Obviously, WHO also issued the guidelines for the same. And it was seen that baseline elevated coagulation derangements were there as compared to non-users of oral contraceptive pills. Mild asymptomatic women also left using CHCs. A huge panic was created, and only 14% of the people resorted to backup contraception of any other sort. So that resulted in sudden withdrawal bleeding. Again, people who were having mild symptoms or were asymptomatic, it was not of much concern. But in serious and hospitalized patients, it was difficult to manage this bleeding because usually for managing sudden withdrawal bleeding, we are resorting to tranexamic acid. Now, tranexamic acid was serving as a dual-edged sword. It was looking as an attractive treatment for COVID-19-related respiratory symptoms, inflammation, etc. But again, those reports of using tranexamic acid for treating COVID-19 symptoms, CHC withdrawal-related bleeding, came up with concerns of hypercoagulability and disastrous thromboembolic events. So it was again not used. Then came to our rescue WHO newsroom, and they said that if this is the concern, then we can switch on to progestin only or any other non-hormonal method if available and acceptable. So now availability and acceptability was added to this clause again, which was a challenge. So this is a table which is combining both ACOG and RCOG guidelines. They said that mild symptom or having no symptoms, COVID-19 patients can continue using COCs. Hospitalized patients have to discontinue it and start to do molecular weight heparin therapy. But the important point that they issued was that the decision to switch from COCs to other alternative forms of contraception should be taken only after considering the fact that discontinuation of COCs requires at least 2 months to restore coagulation parameters, because this seemed to be the major indication for discontinuing it at that time, and the strong protection it offers to avoid unwanted pregnancy. So this had to be documented and somewhere discussed when we were counseling them. Then came vaccine, and with vaccine came a lot of myths. We were trying to bust those myths this way or that way. I'm sure every consultant who is watching this program must have received close to 50 to 100 calls, which vaccine should we take, which vaccine will not interfere when I'm on oral contraceptive pills or progesterone-only pills or any other method like LARC, et cetera. So British Pregnancy Advisory Service, it issued guidelines, and they said that CHC, if a woman is using, she should not wait or delay it for a specific type of vaccine. They said any vaccine is as good as any other vaccine. So they should not be saying that I will prefer this vaccine, I would like to go for that vaccine because it is having lesser thromboembolic event or whatever the data said at that time. Second, this problem with Johnson & Johnson's Janssen COVID-19 vaccine, which came up with issues of TTTS and thromboembolic event. Again, in August 2021, they said that CHC users can safely use it because the risk were equal to the background risk factors. So what did we learn? A lot. And now it's the time whether we have to think whether continued efforts in this direction are needed. All are getting relaxed. We are seeing a COVID third wave will be coming. It will not be coming. When it will be coming, we all are waiting. So the thing is, we have all to learn, unlearn, and relearn. So in this age of artificial intelligence, I may look like this in my human form, I may look like that in my artificial intelligence forms. Whether I like it or not, I have to accept it. Maybe I start liking it also at some point of time. So we have to resort to some smart methods like teleconsultation, prescribe a longer list of drugs, reduce contact visits, be more smart in lining them up for follow-up visits also. So let's have a quick fact check. Prescription-bound are all the COCs, CHCs, non-hormonal contraceptives, are they prescription-bound? No. As WHO has released a guideline that you don't need to prescribe anything, majority are non-prescription contraception. We were thinking that every contraceptive before everything, we have to do mandatory physical examination. But again, they have reiterated the fact that blood pressure, sugar, if she is uncontrolled diabetes mellitus, and a per speculum examination before resorting to LARC, especially IUCD, is required. That's it. And we can actually use absent social media, not for TikToking or anything else, but for promoting verified information, again, to the people who need it the most. So a few questions. One, safety. How safe are contraceptives when we are suffering with COVID-19 or when we are having this lurking danger of COVID-19 anytime we go outside. So the answer is simple and clear. All modern methods of contraceptive are safe. The only issue is with breast cancer sufferers and survivors, those who are having uncontrolled blood pressure, diabetes mellitus, or having active COVID disease, you need to consult your doctor. Question two, best method. Can we have that? This comes as surprise, condoms. So as I said, it is best method, not the safest or most efficacious method. If it is used with correct method and consistency, it prevents not only pregnancies, but also HIVs and STDs. LARC, especially in postpartum periods, whatever institutional deliveries we are having, we can actually promote them for having PPI UCD. It will save, it's like a stitch in time, saving nine. Then again, coming back to fertility-based awareness methods, not the best ones, but yes, they are the options. Question number three, how can we help our patients in these times? Giving them longer prescription, giving them advice for long-acting methods, teleconsultation, and addressing their anxiety over phone or maybe on video calls also. Somebody wants to change the method, especially CHC to other, as the panic is there. So during restricted movement, when doctor is not available, it is actually not the best time. But yes, as Shobha ma'am has already said, Praraksar has also highlighted the fact progesterone is the champion of the town nowadays, especially during COVID times. So progesterone-only pills or progesterone methods are coming out to be good ones. IUD has exceeded time. There is lockdown. I cannot go to doctor. I don't want to visit it because I'm not yet vaccinated. Then you can use other method. Medically, there is no problem with keeping IUCD, especially for 3 to 6 weeks and maybe more. We still have to search for data. And yes, don't advise self-removal. Question number five, emergency contraception pill. It prevents 95% of the unwanted pregnancies, and it is actually an emergency. Question about vaccine, if one is taking emergency contraception pill and she has to go for her vaccine, she can go. Awareness about safe period can also be explained to these patients. OTC and doorstep delivery, as there are so many policymakers today amongst us, this can be promoted. Do contraceptive method decrease efficacy of vaccine or vice versa? No, as yet. But there is no solid evidence and there is no robust data. But as far as we have to answer any question in yes or no, it is still no. So with this, this is a small reel that I made for Instagram. Don't let COVID control, consult your doctor, vaccines and contraception, they can never fight. And thank you, pull up birth control anytime. It saves, it is a savior to reduce unwanted pregnancies, abortions, maternal and neonatal morbidities and mortalities. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Shaila, for a very lucid, practical and focused presentation. I think you addressed the question of choice, the correct medical advice, as well as the practical necessity which all our patients seek from us. Thank you so much for a wonderful talk. And I know you've studied exhaustively to try and get the references and the up-to-date figures. So kudos to you for that. Again, at the end, let me express my gratitude to Dr. Manindra Ahuja ma'am for organizing such a fantastic program and also for having me here. Thank you so much. Take care. God bless.
Thank you, Dr. Shaila and Dr. Pratik Tambe for real good inputs. And I agree COVID-19 was a difficult time because the couples were really locked together. They needed the contraception and they had sexuality problems also. And they had a increased women, violence against women war also increased. So those were the difficult times. Let's all wish there's no way third, because we are already, I think, progressing ahead with our vaccinations. And let's keep our fingers crossed that it has sort of become now endemic, with the cases will be coming and we will have to learn to live with it. And of course, contraception should never be neglected, and rather women's health should never be neglected. And in future also, they should always be made part of all the research activities which are going on, not as a just fallout of other research on the men, but the women should be included in all the research parameters. So with that, because we are running short of time, so Shaila, let's start with our next session, I think. Pratik, please stay on if you don't mind.
And yes, ma'am, I'll be here in the background. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, sir. And
thank you, ma'am.
Well, it was a wonderful presentation. Congratulations. Real good work, your statistics and your presentation and cartoons, and of course the reference to AI, which is very close to my heart now, because my next webinar on the 28th is going to be on the artificial intelligence, because that is not the future. It is already there. Artificial intelligence is already there in our lives, and it has to be there for the care of health of women also. Shala, please, over to you.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. Can we have the CVs display, please? So we already are seeing a beautiful smile on our screen, Dr. Kavita Agarwal. And she is another dynamic person, famous across the nation, associate professor at BMMC and Safdarjung Hospital, chairperson of infertility subcommittee of AOGD, vice president of IMA, South Delhi branch, training in infertility from Rainbow IVF Agra in 2017, and she trained in infertility from ICI 2020. National corresponding editor of Jogi from 2017 to 20, and organizing joint secretary of UH Conference 2017. It was highly successful when even I attended it and presented papers, etc. So most welcome, Dr. Kavita Agarwal, our own winner of Foxy Dr. Kyomini Rao Oration Award, Korean Award, Foxy CS Dawn Prize, Foxy MTP Committee Award, ICOG MQO Travel Award, and Dr. APJ Abul Kalam Appreciation Award. She was all-rounder Yuva and won 28 prizes in various conferences. I am sure you must be having a separate room for your prizes and awards, Dr. Kavita. So the dice is all yours to introduce our luminary adjudicators, Professor Chandravati ma'am and Professor Manindar Ahuja ma'am, and the subject experts too.
Thank you, Dr. Sela, for the kind words. It's my pleasure to share the dice with such luminaries. Thank you, Manindar ma'am, for making me a part of it. It's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Chandravati ma'am.
She have been introduced, Kavita.
Okay, ma'am. Okay, but I would just say she's the teachers of teachers, and I'm honored to have you here, ma'am. Can we have
Thank
the
you,
next?
Thank you very much, Kavita. Thank you.
Namaskar, madam. Manindar ma'am, she needs no introduction. We all know her by the innovative, thought-provoking leader and SMLM, the society she has started, the founder president, the president of Indian Menopausal Society. I've been seeing her in the Indian Menopausal Society from a long, long time. And she has been the president of FOGS, associate editor of Midlife Health, peer reviewer, editor of many, many journals, and many, many awards to her credit. Okay. Welcome, ma'am. Thank you so much for including me. And it's my pleasure to introduce our subject experts, Dr. Basav Mukherjee, who is the Vice President, FOXI 2021-22, Vice President, Bengal Obs Gynae Society, member ICOG Governing Council, and he has been also associated with many, many associations. Welcome, sir. Dr. Parag, sir, has already given a very nice talk. And he's a senior consultant of SGYNE Pune. He's the vice chairperson ICOG. Before that, he was a secretary ICOG, a very humble person, a very helpful person. President-elect Pune of SGYNE Society, national website editor, FOXI. He has been the co-editor of many books, contributed many articles, delivered orations, guest lectures, and we have just now heard his wonderful lecture. Also the recipient of CS John Prize. Welcome, sir. Dr. Shobha Gudi, ma'am, we have heard to her also. She is chairperson, Family Welfare Committee, FOXI. She is the president, BSOD 2018. She is a distinguished TNB teacher. We have seen the wonderful talk given by her.
I would like to say that Kavita has been one of the most productive members of my committee. And she works absolutely selflessly. And I think if there were more members like her, you know, every committee would flourish so much. But nevertheless, and she inspires others also. Kavita, thank you for being there in Family Welfare Committee consistently. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. I'm honored. Welcome, ma'am. It's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Charmila. She is MBBS from Coimbatore, MD from Mumbai. She's chairperson, clinical research committee, FOCSI, ICOG governing council member, national coordinator, UNICEF, MEDA FOCSI PG program, past secretary, Treichiops Gynae Society, president of menstrual hygiene management, joint secretary, treasurers of various associations. Welcome, ma'am. It's my honor to share the dice with you. Next, I would like to invite Dr. Ashish, sir. He is Director, Asha IVF Center, Pune. Director, Asha Kiran Hospital, Pune. He is the Secretary-elect, Pune Obs Gynae Society, Executive Vice President, Pune Obs Gynae Society. He has also been associated with various organizations, recipients of many awards, Young Achiever Award, Kamini Rao Oration Award, FOCSI Future Award, Young Researcher Award, peer reviewer, editors of many journals, books. Welcome, sir. So we will be talking about today the challenges in the contraception, and we'd like to find some solutions and some strategies, the way forward. So let's talk about it. And we start with the adolescent girl. We all know with the adolescent girl, 18-year-old unmarried, sexually active college-going girl. She wants contraceptive advice. This is a routine patient now in our OPDs. So what can we advise her when we are facing certain challenges and certain barriers? When we talk about long-acting, there comes a challenge of acceptance. And when we talk about continuous short-acting, we come to the challenge of continuation. So I would request my experts to give us some strategies, to give us some ways how to do it.
This type of challenge is very, very common, the common going college-going girls. I think it is very rare that they come to you for advice without any reasons. Most of the times, they have some advices from the peer reviewers, from the friends and other people, or they go on the Google and try to find out something. It is only when they are, you know, sort of caught up into some situations, sometimes they miss their period or by chance they become pregnant. And that is the time they come to us for consultation. And I think that is the best time for us to sort of counsel them and talk to them clearly and tell them that it would be advisable for them to go get free of this situation right now, but for future situations, we would like to know what are her relations with the people she's going around. Is this the single partner, multiple partners, what type of partnership she has? And accordingly, we need to talk to her about acceptance, because all type of contraceptive advices are good for the young and nulliparous girls. And we could tell them about each one of them and leave the choice to the girl. Because if you force them with something, they probably, most of the time, there's a discontinuation. So leave the choice to them and freely tell them that if they are uncomfortable, they can always come and
Dr. Basan.
They can always change the method. So I think that is the best way. And right now, many of the colleges and students are given some sex educations and about their fertility control and what sort of things they need to know about it. And maybe that sometimes this young girl walks into your cabin and tries to find out from you what she should do because she is sexually active and what precautions she can do. And then that is the time you can counsel her and talk to her.
So very well said, ma'am. Basically, we are giving the basket of choice. Dr. And our motto is that she should get some contraception before she leaves her hospital gate. I would like others also to contribute to it. Yes.
Dr. Basab, your view?
Yes.
Then I'll
Yeah.
Thanks, Dr. Manindar. It's a pleasure to be here in your program, Dr. Manindar. It's the first time I'm here. And
Madam, apna mute kar lijiye. Yes, Dr. Basab.
Yeah, so I think the few points which I think we need to all understand is that when an 18-year-old girl walks into your OPD, she walks in with a lot of apprehension and she walks in with a lot of expectation. Also, in a way, you can consider her brave in that way, because the rest of the people will be much older to her, and the very fact that she's coughed up enough of courage to come there and sit in front of you, that's the first positive, I think, that you get there, that this lady has come here to get some advice or to at least to get some solution to her problem. So that's the first important thing, which I think is important to put us in perspective about this lady is expecting a lot from us, and we need to deliver, we need to help her out. That's number one. Number two is when young people have sex, they don't think of pregnancy. They just think about the enjoyment of having sex. They don't think about STIs. So I think what Kavita also mentioned is that there are a lot of knowledge gaps in a lot of women. And that is something which this is an opportunity to address that and to really educate her or counsel her, even if that's not her purpose. But this is a chance that you get to tell her something about birth control, about not having, not becoming pregnant when you don't want to, which will help her in the long run. The question is about what methods you will offer her and what she will choose. That's totally personally her choice. After all the discussion you may have, she may just walk out and say, I'm doing fine with an eye pill. I'm doing fine with a condom, and I'm happy with that, and I'll continue using that. Thank you very much, doctor. Or she may say that, okay, I think I may have a little bit more intercourse than possibly a one-off thing, so I may use OC pills. But OC pills and condoms, what WHO generally has said, the dual method of contraception, may not always work in clinical practice. But again, we do understand that you have to avoid a pregnancy and avoid STIs, and that would be naturally the line of work, path which you will do. IUCDs for young girls, IUCDs for unmarried girls, in my practice, very limited. I think most of us also would see it very limited in everybody. Kavita, I think you should ask everybody Dr. Kavita, you should ask people by name in panels. You just don't say, please say something. Always ask, because as a panel moderator in several panels over the last couple of decades, I've understood one thing. You must address panelists by name. Do not say that if somebody has something to say, please say, because nobody will say. Okay. A lot of people keep quiet. Ask Ashish first. I think everybody's smiling. Okay. Ashish,
okay. Pick up from where Basav concluded about dual method. I will always emphatically tell them, of course. As you said, compliance may not be there. But there will be two options here. One is that we give them a steady method of contraception, offer the basket for all the pills, and including the implant, including the IUCD, because these are girls who will have a long tenure of premarital sex. They really require LARC, actually speaking, because they'll be involved in their education, career path, etc. They won't have that much time to remember to take pill every day. Whatever it is, one method like that plus the barrier. Suppose the woman refuses and wants to walk out, then tell her, okay, you continue the barrier, but tell her in detail about emergency contraception, the pros and cons. So this is the dual method again. It is barrier plus the EC. That is what I have to say.
Yeah. I think one point, Dr. Kavita, I need to mention, I think Dr. Chandravati also said it. I think it's so important not to be judgmental. I think that is one thing which puts off a lot of girls once they walk in and you say, kya ho raha hai, padhne ka time hai, kya, what are you worried about sex? This is the time to study, padhne ka samay hai, kya, what are you doing? How are you wasting your life? Just a couple of comments and a couple of sneers is all you would like to just shut her off from any medical profession in the next few years. So I think those are something which you need to avoid at all points, at the medical, at the doctor level, definitely, even at the healthcare staff who are in the hospital. Just a couple of sneers, just a couple of comments would be enough to put her off a few years from coming to a healthcare facility, near a healthcare facility. So I think those are very, very dangerous, which we all have to very carefully remember. Dr. Professor Chandravati is there, ma'am.
I'll tell you an example. Yesterday, I had a little girl, young girl who had come to me, who had taken MTP pill. And I sent her, because she was incomplete abortion, sent her for an ultrasound. And the person who was doing ultrasound didn't know whether to do abdominal or transvaginal, because he thought she's unmarried. So he was, sort of worrying. And he just asked whether I should do transvaginal or this. So somebody just said, no, she is in relationship. And they came, the couple came back down to me and they felt offended because it was just said that she is in relationship. So small things what we talk or employees talk or our assistant talks can put off the couple and they may leave your clinic without taking an advice from you. So we have to be very fair. Basav said we have to be very, very careful about judging any couple or any girl or anyone.
Okay, during counseling, we have to be very careful.
To our employees so, as well as madam, everyone.
I think
Dr. Charmila, ma'am, can we have from you also some input?
Madam, can I say something?
Yeah, sir, please. No, you're audible.
We are not heard at that time. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you, Maninder, madam, for involving me. I am really happy to interact with all of you. About the adolescent, madam, what I feel is the basic their needs is to first of all you greet with the people that age. How the doctor is greeting to the person in that particular age that matters. Secondly, is the interaction and what is the choices are given to her. It is actually those are the girls when they come to your OPD or anyone's OPD, they have their certain things that is fixed up, or they have their mental backup. Was talking to some other person in a vicinity or some other girl. So it is always better to have a greeting, then you have to have educations, then have interactions, and then putting forward the choices will be a much more easier way to interact with them because the age that has a different role to play.
Actually, yeah. When these adolescent girls come to me, when they go back, they are already my friends. So they know that they can depend upon me because the moment they sit down, I know we can make out whether they are married or not. So the first question I'll ask them, or they will tell me, I missed my period. Yes, of course, a non-judgmental way, I just ask them, are you in a relationship? It's okay. Then I look at them, whether they are pregnant, advise them, whatever way we have to do. Then when I finished with everything, then I say, what will you be doing for the future? And you know what they are telling me, we are using IPLs. Then I have to tell them it's not advisable. So what they have to do? How many times are they having? If they say they are very infrequent intercourse and they are not actually living together, that means then you can tell them about safe method plus condom use. Because then they say they want their freedom. No, none of them is going to take the OCP pills. They are not going to carry that thing into their purses or anything. So we cannot advise them. Yes, adolescent, what I have in mind is implanon. Those who are in continuous relationship, they are living together, are more than 3 or 4 times in a month they are doing. Implanon is the government of India should be advising for the adolescent also. It's high time we should move ahead. That is where I want advice of all of you, opinion of all of you, whether we should or we should not. Implanon for unmarried girls.
Very much possible.
This is the one. So this is one step forward when we are making a white paper. We on this conference we'll be making. I like everybody's input that why not implanon for our girls when they are being given that all over world. So they are safe and they are convenient. We cannot tie them. It's their hormones are going haywire. We cannot give them lectures. Na karo, na karo, na karo. Why shouldn't they do it? My question is, why shouldn't they do it? But they should keep it safe. That's all. That is what the message, I think, we are already coming into so much of now, internet and everything is there. It's not our educated class, it's an uneducated class. It's our maids. Everybody is doing it. So we have to make them safe.
Yeah, Manindraji, can I come in?
Yes, sir.
I think that's an important point that everybody is doing it. So why not we do it? I think in our college education programs, which all of us do go for, we also go. I think one of the things is that losing your V or losing your virginity is not a fad. I think that's something which is important to understand. That it's not a peer pressured thing that just because some of your friends have had sex that you also have to have it. I think the not having intercourse is an option. Not having sex is an option. Or having sex when you want to have is an option. And it hasn't to be something related to a peer pressure. It's a totally individual choice. It is a totally a person, which will be a personal choice by a person. and he or she has to take full responsibility whenever they are ready for it. So I think nobody, I agree with Dr. Maninder that anybody can have intercourse at any time, irrespective of marital status. Obviously, that's, we've moved a long far from that. But at the same time, just because a person is in a relationship, that doesn't mean that he or she has to have sex. So I think that is another important thing. Usually it happens, but it doesn't have to happen. So abstinence is also one of the different things in which people can have been in a relationship. You do not have to have intercourse. I think that is something which we can share in college awareness programs. It doesn't have to be a peer pressure thing. It doesn't have to be a in the sink thing, that if you're not having, if you're not having it, that you're not really grown up or you're not there. So wo baat bhi sahi hai. I think that's also, you have to balance the messaging, what you want to do. So balance the messaging, I think, is an important thing. I agree with your point, Dr. Bharinder, but we have to balance the messaging, and I think that's an important thing.
Yes, yes.
So now we have advised our contraception, we advised our dual, we advised our EC also, but this patient is going on continuously only taking EC and is not using anything in the routine. She's just going on taking EC pills. So finally, she again came to you back and is asking, can she actually start now after taking EC pill, and what can she start? Dr. Ashish, will you like to throw some light on it?
Madam, basically, when you're talking about the EC, EC has a multiple options to her. Like we have a 3-4 regimes. We have a U-space regime. We have a uliprostol. We have a mifepristone. We have again the IUCDs. But depending upon what, if she's coming on regular basis for ECs only, I think in one menstrual cycles, one time EC is fine, but it is not, should not be, you have to educate her. It's not just giving her EC pill will do our job. The first of all, education of this particular adolescent girls play a role. And then you are talking about whenever, which drug has been given, and then restart of your comprehensive care of any contraceptives.
Dr. Basa, will you like to say something about it? We have counseled her a lot about ECs, regular also use, and then also she's just going on taking ECs. Will you like to counsel her in some other way or something so that finally she understands that she has to start with the routine and she can start it now only?
Okay. Dr. Kavita, I think that's a very important thing to understand. I think in life, we generally want to do the best for our patients. We want them to make the best choices. But unfortunately, the choices that they make are their own. And what we can do is just to help them and guide them. So we can't really force them to pop in pills, or we can't force them to put an implant under their skin. We can't force them to put an LNG IUS into their uterus. So we can't force anything. We can't coerce them. In our best interest, yes, we will be advising them. Yes, we'll be talking to them. Yes, we'll be talking to them more than once. Yes, we'll be trying to counsel them. But the ultimate decision that he or she takes is her own. So even if we know that that's not the best for her, even if we know that repeated medical abortion is not the best idea, whatever a woman accepts or does in her life is absolutely her personal choice. And as a doctor, we cannot take responsibility for it. If she wants to do ECs throughout her life, so be it. We will be continue talking about that's not the best method. We'll be continually talking about that regular contraception should be used. But in her, but if she, that's what she wants, we just cannot be doing anything more. We can't force.
Exactly. Counseling at every visit. And there's
no role for coercion. We cannot force her at any point of time. Not when she's come for a medical abortion, not when she's come for a postpartum checkup, not when she's come for a post-abortion. We cannot force any time. We can just discuss. We'll write in the prescription. We can write elaborately in the prescription, but we cannot force a pill down her throat if she doesn't want to use it.
Yes. Maninder ma'am, Chandravati ma'am, any concluding remarks?
I think Basab has addressed it well.
Yeah.
I think we should move ahead. Doctor.
Okay.
Madam, so one counseling about the pregnancies, unwanted pregnancies. You need to, where you are doing the counseling, the pregnancies or unwanted pregnancy, you have to have just information about it so that she will be able to understand later what are the complications of it. And teenage pregnancies.
Counseling about the STDs, counseling about the future pregnancies, counseling when she gets married and she's not able to conceive. All these things, they have to be told her clearly, but in a non-judgmental way. that we are not against your having, but it's better that you control and keep it safer for your own interest.
Yeah.
But we have to tell her it is in her own interest that she should be in the safe.
Yeah.
Master said, we have to advise them, don't go in for this. If they don't listen to us, we just can't force them.
Correct. Yeah, Kavita, one thing which also matters is about the benefits of contraceptives beyond contraception also matters. So sometimes these girls, when they are very distraught with the irregular periods that they have with the EC, continuous use of EC, they can be told about regularizing periods. There are contraceptives which can achieve that, and also a better quality of life. So I think they do understand when we tell them the benefits, other benefits of contraceptives. And I think there is a very strong research which has there in adolescent sexual behavior, which says that periodic abstinence is well accepted by adolescent, sexually active adolescents, and that should be harnessed. It is well accepted because their sexual debut is earlier. You know, they would have already spent 4 or 5 years by the time they come to us. So they do accept abstinence as one of the methods of contraception. Yeah, periodic abstinence.
Very nice point brought out, ma'am, that telling them about the other advantages of their periods regularization is a nice strategy. So now moving on to the other extreme of the age group, that is perimenopausal. Now this woman at 41 years of age, she got a copper T inserted. She wants to know that now when she becomes 51 and she does not have menopause, does she still needs to get it changed? Dr. Basab, sir, can you please throw some light on it?
I think it's a fairly now well known fact that after 40, if you have a IUCD inserted, you can use it till the age of menopause. So you don't need to take it out even at any point of time. Though the copper will go, it will work like possibly as a mechanical device, but at the same time, you can use it for a very long time. So it will be till the age of menopause. You shouldn't be forgetting that it was ever there. That's one thing, but you can use it for a longer period of time than what the labeled uses. So that's something which we know. Unless in case of an LNG IUS where she used it for heavy menstrual bleeding and she's persisting to have the problem, but usually it doesn't happen at the end of the 5 years. So by the time she can use it for a few more years, and then she can check her FSH, LH, and make sure that she's crossed the menopausal boundary, and then she can take it out. So that's all can be done.
And what about DMPA and OCPs? Dr. Ashish, sir, what is your say on that? Can she keep on continuing using that also till her menopause, or she needs to stop it and switch over to something else?
Yeah, what we was worried about in this particular age group of premenopausal is bone mineral density loss. And in that particular age, if the DMPA has to be given, but there are no sufficient data which will say you this is the particular way that is really responsible for this particular loss of bone mineral density. And if you wish to change it, it's whether you are using it in premenopausal age group, it is definitely has a definitely beneficial effect on the vasomotor symptoms also. So if you have to judge between the two, outweighs the risk versus benefits, and then definitely you can use it.
Yeah. So Dr. Shobha, ma'am, will you like to say something? Till what age group can she use DMPA, OCPs, or she can continue OCPs as HRT also after that? Although Parag sir has already taken a nice lecture on it, but then
Yeah, I think 47.5 years is the average age of menopause in India. But considering the fact that she already has been amenorrheic, it is possible that there is some chance that she has attained menopause. The recommendation is to continue contraception for 1 year after officially declaring her as menopause. So sometimes it becomes a challenge, but Dr. Basab has very rightly pointed out that she should complete the entire tenure of the LNG IUS, 5 years. And after that, you can take a call. One beautiful thing about LNG IUS is if she develops vasomotor symptoms, you can give her just estrogen to control the symptoms. Because progesterone is already there. So it is possible to treat her with small doses of estradiol. But
for her symptoms, vasomotor symptoms. But whether officially the final menstrual period has gone past us, we will come to know only in due course of time when she stops. So 50 years, definitely. Beyond 50 years, sometimes once the tenure of the LARC method is over, after that we can check out if menopause is there or not. Yeah.
Yeah, basically, in this age group, madam, I think we need to understand whether the either is really amenorrhea is because of the some kind of a contraceptive, or because of the amenorrhea is because of the menopause. So then the dilemma starts where to find it, whether it is she's really entered into a menopause or not. And then your FSH, what the previous speaker talked about, plays a role.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. So any concluding remarks from Manindar ma'am, Chandravati ma'am?
I think they have highlighted well that if it is just one thing we have to remember, that our average age of menopause is earlier, 46.2. And if the patient is amenorrheic after getting the Levonorgestrel gestrel, immediately after she goes into amenorrhea, after 1 year or 6 months or 1 year. So that means it's because of the Levonorgestrel only. If she starts having symptoms of menopause despite getting this thing, then perhaps we have to add her on menopause hormone therapy. And about FSH role, sometimes it's controversial, but if it goes beyond 50, then it's definitely menopause is there.
Because one recommendation I can share. One recommendation I can share, that if there is really a dilemma, especially when they are on progesterone only contraception, we can do an FSH level, and if it is more than 30, we can repeat it in 6 weeks' time. And if again it is more than 30, then continue the contraceptive method for 6 months to a year and stop.
Yeah,
so that fulfills the requirement.
If it's above 50, it's confirmed. If it's between 30 and 50,
above 50
again, above we are 50. In doubt.
Yeah,
about 50, yeah.
Yes, so now
we 50 come... only there is a role of FSH. Less than 50, I don't think we should worry. We can continue the contraception. Yeah.
So 50 to 55 is one such period we need to think about it and need to evaluate. Now moving on to another big thing, what we are trying for much time, but we are still not able to achieve, is the male participation. What can be the strategies to increase the male participation in family planning? Dr. Basab, sir. Please.
I think Chandravati ma'am.
Kavita, please, Chandravati ma'am. Actually, I can't see that because in my slide, it's PowerPoint open.
To do the counseling, always a couple counseling. And the husband should be always with the wife there. And that is how you can improve the male participation. Because many times the husbands are away and it's only the wife who listens to everything, and she goes and she forgets. And she doesn't tell her husband even that you need to be a part of this whole program, and there are other methods which you can use, and we can be safer. So I think it is couple counseling which is the should be must for hoping to have the male participation.
Yes, ma'am. Very important point brought about, that is the couple counseling. Any other strategies we can have from our experts?
Yeah. And when we have the couples together, we should try to find out why the males sometimes they don't want to use the condoms. Have any one of us given them choices about the condoms? Do you know what is the market full of condoms at this time? Has anyone, Ashish? Have you searched for the condoms? You are a male. Dr. Chandravati, do you know? I just went to the internet to find out about the condoms, and it's a complete market where the couples can enjoy their sex and have it safe it too. And there are different types of different qualities of condoms available, different flavors of condoms available. So why are we not open about it?
Maninta, that type of advertisement is always there. The best type of condom, you see all the advertisement into. So I think there are ways to impress the male partners. Yeah.
Not the male partners, it's the acceptance of the male partner. Why for the contraception purposes, they don't feel that they have to be involved. The condoms, we can tell them why they have the effective use, of course, but then we can tell them that there are choices available. Just the on the market which is sold or advertised are just a few brands. But if you go on net, there are lots of them available, choices are there, which even I did not know, to be very frank, till I went and searched for it. Secondly, about the male sterilization, I think we have to be trained more people into that without suture vasectomy. So that personally, I feel, because in my time, at least, I had done vasectomies when the that movement for vasectomization of the there by the Sanjay Gandhi. And I was part of that. At that time, I was in the government service. And we had done lots of vasectomies. But if we are trained now to give, stigma is the stitches. Stigma is that they will get sterilized. They will become impotent. And stigma is that they won't be able to work. So that is, these are the, if the barriers we can remove among the males, I think males will be more than happier to participate in the contraception processes.
Madam, too, can I add one thing to
it? Yeah, please.
We need your inputs. Yeah.
Madam, when we are talking about the involvement of the male, the first is a thing that comes to the anyone as a family is a safety. Because if someone is accompanying with you, it's a more safe and services where she is going or whether your family member is going, that particular things comes into your mind. Secondly, is economical growth. If you talk to them that if you don't have too much of children to take care of, or there is something that the contraceptive will help you without causing any effect on your life, and also you can have the economical growth to nurture on. So that can be one of the point when the particular husband comes down to you for counseling.
Dr. Yes. Basan, your intake, how the males have to be involved?
I think it's very difficult to involve males unless you transplant uteruses from the women into the men, because I think that's very, very, it's a challenge which I think people in the government have seen over the last several decades about increasing male participation in family planning. And it's been a huge, 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 huge challenge. And vasectomy, they have pocket drives in some places of the country. And when they have the drives, it increases by a few percentage. Some people are very happy. And then again, their drives go off and then again it decreases. So I think there's a lot of, I think all of us know why male participation is not increasing. As one point was raised was stigma. A lot of misconception on what will happen. Again, condoms decrease sexual pleasure. To vasectomies decrease potency. To vasectomies may affect the earning member of the family. The wives protecting men from not having a vasectomy. I'll take care of all the family planning things. There are very few women who will say that, yes, let the husband get involved. The most of the women will be protective of the husband and say, no, he shouldn't be going for a vasectomy more than the husband. The husband is often not asked. So I think the combined counseling does make sense. But again, in real life, it often doesn't happen. There are very few times when you talk about contraception when the husband and wife and the both partners are sitting there. Many times it will be the wife and the mother-in-law, the wife alone or somebody else in the house and the friendly neighbor who will give some other advice. So very difficult challenge. We haven't got the answer. We still are trying about male participation, how to increase. I think, again, we have to, again, we don't talk about sex. You don't talk about contraception. You don't talk about family planning. The more the conversation, the more I think we'll be opening up and the male participation. But that's still some years away.
Pastor, yeah. While something like going to social media, we are going about ART, what is your ovulation period, this is helping, this is not helping. So I'm making a video, male contraception, male vasectomy, allowed, yes. Would you be sterilized? No. Would you be out of job? No. Can your potency continue? Yes. So can we make some sort of...
हाँ देखिए कितना लाइक्स आ रहा है देखिए हाउ मेनी लाइक्स यू आर गेटिंग हाउ मेनी लाइक्स हाउ मेनी रीट्वीट्स हाउ मेनी फॉरवर्ड्स यू आर गेटिंग फ्रॉम दैट यू सी अ थिंग एंड सी द पॉपुलैरिटी इफ यू कैन ट्राई टू मेक इट वायरल इट डेफिनेटली मेक्स सम इफेक्ट सोशल मीडिया हैज सच अ इंपॉर्टेंट रोल टू प्ले इन एनीथिंग इन आवर लाइव्स नाउ people don't watch the news, people watch the social media. So a lot of people assume ye jo aap bol rahe wo sahi hai. So if it's coming from you, Dr. Manindar, from this organization, then definitely it should play a role. But you must follow it up, what impact it is making. Difficult always to follow, but kitna followers aapka hai, kitna likes hai, kitna retweets hai, kitna ye hai, that'll give some idea. But it's worth trying. Obviously, it's worth trying, exactly, because we have to look at some new approaches.
Yeah. This time in Safdarjung also on world population.
If I don't get reply back, it's okay.
Dr. Shobhai will help you and I'll also help you.
This time in Safdarjung also on the world population, we did the Nukkad Natak on this topic only on vasectomy.
At least we should start taking one step forward. We should not think that this is not possible, this is not feasible. Basav, you know me. I never say die. Never say stop it. This cannot be done. It can be done. Let's move. Let's make it a movement. Yeah. The purpose of these webinars should be the ideas which are not being carried forward. They should be made into a movement.
They surely, Manindar. Surely.
So, ma'am. So, Dr. Manindar, when you have your gym videos, so in your gym videos for 2 days, and then you'll have one of this for one day, and then.
Awesome exercise did make an impression.
No, it's good. I'm not making fun of it. I'm just saying it's good. I'm just saying to mix it, mix and match.
Yeah. So waiting for Manindar ma'am's video. Till the time we now move on to the COVID pandemic, family planning services should not stop. So here the women was already on OCPs. First, we are talking, I've divided this into two. So first, let's start with the myths that individuals who are already using contraception. So starting with OCP, she had mild COVID infection. Now she has recovered. Can she continue it?
Yes, Dr. she can continue, Kavita. She can continue. And I just wanted you to check who will be taking the questions in the chat box, because people are asking also.
Yeah. I think Manindar ma'am or Dr. Sehla, if you can see, because
if you can take them, then they feel more rewarded. Those who are asking.
Yeah.
Kavita, take them as and when they come.
Ma'am, I think just this COVID, and then I'm coming to telemedicine. That is the last.
Then we start taking in between also questions we can take, because panelists are there.
Yeah, so after COVID, just finishing with the telemedicine. So just in the COVID, already on contraception, I just wanted to put up a point of the extended use, which has the recent, which has come up. So just wanted to ask if the patient is on DMPA injection, it's due, or copper T380A, the replacement is due, or she's on LNG IUS and a replacement is due. Dr. Shobha ma'am, can you please help us help these patients?
This copper will depend on which one. 375 will not act as a contraceptive once 5 years are over. But 380 can go up to 12 years. So no hurry there. The implant can be used up to 4 years, no problem. LNG IUS up to 6 years, no problem. But DMPA beyond 14 weeks, we cannot say that it will protect. So it can be converted to a subcutaneous DMPA, and she could be shown a video to self-inject. So there comes self-care and contraception in a very strong way. Thank you.
Yeah, plus we will have to tell her about the backup and to come for follow-up there is a missed period.
Yes.
And also there is no hurry for removal. It can silently lie in the body. It's not going to hurt her, and she can just start with the POPs if she can't come to the hospital.
Yeah, bridging methods can be started. POP, even barrier can be advised, no problem.
So now coming to telemedicine.
Can I make a point, Dr.
Kavita, before you move on?
I think this is a fun, I think it's because it's a fun discussion, so we'll make it light. So I think when Corona came in 1.5 years ago, a lot of us almost were sure that SIRH services will be severely affected. And we were sure that people are not getting contraception. And a lot of people are, because it's a quarantine, they're at home, they're having a lot of sex, and you'll have a large baby boom at the end of the year, and we'll call it coronials. So the corona quarantine babies, which will come up. But somehow that didn't happen. It didn't happen because people didn't have as much sex as you thought they'll have. They were all depressed. Contraceptive they managed somehow. They continued to use either the IPL or something, and they managed somehow. And also medical abortion sales didn't decrease. They just went the same graph as they normally have gone. So I think somewhere, I think the contraceptive services may not have been affected as much as we thought, or as well as a lot of the data was projecting. The FRHS data, we all understand that low risk, medium risk, and high risk. A lot of us understood that the worst case scenario, whatever happened, but that baby boom, which they thought will be happening at any time in the late last year or early this year, never really took place. So I think we are mistaken by saying that it was grossly affected. I think the real life scenario would be at the most very mild. That's my take on it. It's a light one, but this is something which we cannot
be. Yeah, but this corona has given us telemedicine. So now the problem is that there is a 35-year-old woman. She does not want to come to the OPD and she wants telemedicine. And as she wants COC, so she was advised to upload her BP. Now she's feeling very upset about it, that I don't have a BP apparatus. If I need to go to a dispensary or go to a pharmacist, go somewhere for a BP apparatus, I can go and take the COCs also. So what is your take on that?
I think Amazon and Flipkart is the answer. So Amazon and Flipkart can give them a BP machine and their house. The very fact that they're ordering their dinner, the pizza is coming the same way. So Amazon and Flipkart will come in the same way. So BP measurement should not be a problem. That's my take on it. I'm sure that there are other people.
On this, I would like to just pose this study here, which was done in 2020. On this similar, they were interviewed that what do they think about it and how did they take the BP? So these are some of the responses we got. One of the patients said, I had an old reading, maybe few months or few years back, and I feel that I am perfectly healthy. So I uploaded that reading because I wanted the COC advice. The other patients told that we just Googled up that what is actually the normal BP reading. And we found out from the Google and we uploaded that Google reading. And only few of them actually took the reading, and that also they took multiple previous readings. They took the mean out of it and then they uploaded it. So now what is the take, that what is the future of telemedicine after this corona pandemic has ended? Should we continue with it? What is actually the future of it? If the patients for a BP reading, they can give a false reading, just seeing the Google, they can go like this, then what is the future of it? Dr. Ashish, sir. Yeah. I think Chandravati ma'am wants to say something. Yeah, Chandravati ma'am. What do you think is the future of telemedicine?
I think the telemedicine has to stay. It would be there. But we should not, sort of depend on such findings. And our things would be that suppose even slightly blood pressure is high, can we safely prescribe this drug or not? And when we are prescribing, we must also inform the client or the person who's going to take it that please be careful if you are mentioning, please mention the correct blood pressure readings. So telemedicine has to stay. In these eras of pandemic, we have seen that you cannot work without it. So many things we had to do it on telecommunications. The drugs had to be sent to the patient's house and all the arrangements had to be done. So we need to wait for it. Maybe in a few years, we would be much better off with this thing. And maybe there would be arrangement for taking
BP. Madam, can I say something?
Yes,
like
sir. Yes, Dr.
Yes,
in the end, I'll say.
Yes. Yeah. Madam, I think whenever you're talking about the BP reading, it is the need for that contraception or need for that pills that makes them to give a false reading or whatever the previous reading is. One need to understand whenever we are going to prescribe something to any of the patient, we need to talk to them why it is to be important of taking the readings accurately. Because these are the study, what you are quoting is from the Manchester, and they had done this study in a telemedicine where they quote the questions to the the client, and these are the readings from them. So actually, when you are talking, what is the need of it and why it is important? If something, why the BP is important in your taking of the OC pills? If the patient knows about the importance, then they will upload the correct reading. And the telemedicine is going to stay. It is not the not going to go away with the, even if after the pandemic, because we do have a telemedicine consultation from abroad also. So it will going to be a near future normal.
So sir, do you think it can replace an in-person visit?
No, yes. It would not replace. The visit needs to be there. I don't think, Kavita, it can ever replace.
Dr. Basav, sir, right. What will you like to say? Is it providing an equitable access to everyone? Or is just going for only a few people who can have the online access?
I think one thing, Kavita, the question about few people online access is gone. Out of the 140 crores of Indians, 90 crores have smartphones. And that's the last one. I think 90 crores have a smartphone, but the 90 crores smartphones going around. Some people may have more than one. But I think I think the digital media has already penetrated into all fragments of society, urban and rural. So we cannot say that digitalization hasn't taken place. Now the question is, how are people using their smartphones? Most are using it for social media. Very few are using it for e-commerce. And what about e-health? E-health somehow hasn't picked up as much as the other parameters. Even in your own practice, you understand, even in your own household, you use the phone for WhatsApp. That's the most you use for mail. That's another use. And the other things which you use it for is sometimes maybe some other Facebook and Twitter and other things, Instagram. But the using it for health, using it for information, using it for Google Maps, yes. But normal Google, I think that's something which we still aren't yet tuned for. So telemedicine is there to stay. There's no question about it. Doctors generally are ready for it, healthcare providers, I think in some of us, but I think a lot of people are not ready for it. People want to see doctors physically. People want to see them, touch them, be close to them to really get healed. And that is something which I think may change with time, but it will take some time for people to really accept telemedicine, because we all had the telemedicine consultation at a peak when there was quarantine, but again, quarantine went off and now all patients are coming back to the clinic. It's at the low ebb. So I think telemedicine is here to stay, but the question is, when will it pick up? How will it pick up? The advantages are numerous. The answers are will emerge with time. I think it will have its place sometime down the line.
So here I would just like to give an example that if we go to a restaurant, when we go to a restaurant, we may order some drinks. We may also order with the meal a dessert, or maybe also when we are going, we can do shopping. So it's many things we are doing together. Similarly, when a person comes to us in the OPD, when we are sitting there and the person comes, we can chest auscultation, a blood pressure, or maybe if he might agree to the lock services, and IUCD insertion, PS examination, PV examination. So we are doing many additional tests, many additional things. We are giving a wholesome treatment to the patient when she is coming, even for a family planning service advice, when she's actually coming to us in the OPD. This is one thing which we are not able to provide, but yes, telemedicine is providing us a lot. There's more utilization, less rush in the OPDs. We can give more time. Patients are more comfortable, and in fact, adolescents, they are more comfortable with technology. So I think both of these are required, as very well said by the experts, as well as Chandravati ma'am. I think both of these are required. At the digital place, we can counsel the patient for a lark. And if she agrees to it, then she can be referred to a healthcare center. Again, at follow-up, we will need digital services, and referral, if required, can be done. So we need the combination of both the things. What Corona has given us, a telecommunication, is definitely here to stay, but along with the OPD services. Yes, Maninder ma'am, will you please like to sum up
about e-medicine, artificial intelligence? It is already there. And the biggest market for all the technological institution, IT sector now is the health, e-health. E-health, they are coming in a big way. The companies are being taken over, and our data will be there with all the IT companies, which will be giving its artificial intelligence. Because when you put on the mobile number or the name of a person, her complete past history of the test and the health chart will be there. That will become very, very easier for us. And it is there. They are collecting data, and from thousands to lakhs and millions, they will be very soon, because the machine learning is very, very fast, and it is going to be there. Yes, we are not accepting it, but in a large way, it's coming. On the 28th, we are having a webinar under SMLM again on the artificial intelligence. Please be there. In the meantime, you all of you read about it, how the artificial intelligence is coming. There are some questions before you leave. You have to answer them. Yeah. People, delegates have joined from Bangladesh. They have joined from Nepal. They have joined from all the CEFOC countries here and CEFOMS countries. And all of them are appreciating this panel and these discussions. And they have appreciated all the panelists and all the speakers. So I'm not going to name them. Dr. Zinat Naseen is anyway, Lakshmi Shrikhanda is there anyway. Shobha, have you left because she wanted to leave? And the one question was there, if we give, when we are using levonorgestrel IUD, is there depression increased? Anxiety and depression increased? Somebody has asked that question. Anybody can answer?
No, I don't think. I've used a lot of levonorgestrel IUD CTs. I don't find there is any evidence of a depression in these cases. No.
Okay, the two lower segments, LSCS, the husband should go for vasectomy. Can we make it into a law? Women had to be had her abdomen open.
That is so sweet of you.
Don't have to be made into a, they don't even need an incision.
I really enjoyed today.
छोटे बच्चे में नहीं करते ना, यंग चाइल्ड, वी आर नॉट डूइंग इट टू, वी आर नॉट डूइंग दैट स्टफ, परमानेंट स्टरिलाइजेशन एज अल्लाह.
मनिंदर बीबी नहीं करने देगी, बीबी करने ही नहीं देगी आदमी का.
तो फिर काउंसलिंग,
मैं तो हम लोग बहुत देख चुके हैं, बहुत कर चुके हैं काउंसलिंग, बीबियां करने ही नहीं देती हैं, वो तो बचा के रखती हैं उनको बिल्कुल.
Okay, one question was, can OCPs and progesterone be used to treat AUB following COVID vaccination? Yes.
After yes, vaccination. Yes.
Everything is safe after. Can OCPs and what generation be prescribed to a woman taking steroids for autoimmune diseases? Shobha?
No, I don't think oral contraceptive pills should be used when there is inflammatory processes going on.
And so, yeah, when not. The active inflammation is there, autoimmune, we cannot use it. Fantastic panel. We are all used to our immunity. In COVID-19, COVID pandemic, please remember about increased chances of thromboembolic phenomena. So prescribe COCs with a pinch of caution in patients who suffered from COVID. Take care even after vaccination, prescribed after coagulation profile done. Should we be doing those who have suffered, should we be doing coagulation profile before prescribing them COCs?
I think, Maninder, we should be restricting oral pills for some time in people who have active COVID infection for some time. We should take precaution not to prescribe after 3 to 4 months once they have completely recovered. I think one can advise them. They can go only progesterone pill then.
Yeah, barrier method at least 6 months.
Barrier or only progesterone pill they can take.
Later complications of COVID were also being reported. They are still being reported.
So yeah, we have to be careful about this.
We should be careful about that.
Chandravati ma'am, mere ko excuse karenge. Maninder ji, please excuse.
Yes, we are also. Thank you very much, Shobha. You were a great contributor.
Yeah. And thank you, Chandravati ma'am.
I need to leave too, Dr. Maninder. Namaste, namaste,
bacha.
Fine, and we are taking a photograph and we are ending it here.
Yeah, fine.
But also use non-hormonal chaya or centchromen, that is non-hormonal. So that can also be advised to the
patient.
Kavita, हम लोग ने non-hormonal Sevista बहुत use किया है.
Yes,
and we were in the trial also because it is from the CDRI from Lucknow only.
Yeah.
The only thing we found was that using this weekly pills, there were chances of ovarian enlargement. So one has to be careful about that only. सबिस्टम लोग अभी भी देते हैं, सहेली बहुत यूज करते
हैं. If we change over from Savista, then the cysts are gone.
They disappear.
So that is one thing. So I think it's time to say thank you to everybody.
Thank you, Maninder. All speakers, wonderful.
All the panelists, thank all you. The chairperson.
आज बहुत देर तक पढ़ा लिया तुमने.
Jackson, Paul.
Thank you, madam.
And I
thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Ashish, you have to help me for making a white paper. We'll be sharing the video of this thing, YouTube videos, and from that you can take help. And help us to make a sort of white paper. Shaila has
left. Madam. Anytime.
Thank you very much.
I'm here.
Thank you, Deepika. She's always there. Yeah, Shaila is there. Shaila, yes. You have to take on from here now. Okay. Thank you very
thank
much.
You so much.
And thank you, Kavita. Your panel was wonderful. And so was Dr. Shobha Gudi, Dr. Parag Biniwale, Shaila's talk, and all the chairpersons and all the panelists. In the discussions have done well. Dr. Ajay chale gaye the, he's left.
He has left. He had certain meeting.
Anyway, so male contraception we have to work on. Please wait for my video and then make it viral. For the male.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for making us a part of this academic tree.
Bye-bye.
Thank you,
good night.
Thank you, Dr.
Ajay. Bye-bye.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye, everyone.